Hello, my name is Daniel G. Wilson, and this is DGAW Interviews. Today, on Interviews, I'll be talking to... New Design.
What up?
Yo.
Hi guys, how are you doing today?
Really good. It's good. Thanksgiving weekend. We just played a show yesterday.
Excellent.
And yeah, we're about to eat some food tonight. It's gonna be awesome.
Lots of turkey?
Yep, hopefully.
Yeah, I had Thanksgiving. Hopefully.
I don't know. I don't know if there's going to be lots of turkey.
Yeah, there might not be enough.
Yeah, you never know, right?
So, the main thing is if there's enough gravy. You want enough gravy.
Yeah, do you eat cranberry with your turkey?
No.
Yeah, no.
Yeah.
I don't do that. That's crazy. That's weird. Do you eat cranberry with your turkey?
Separately, actually, in a bowl.
Separately in a bowl. Interesting.
With a spoon.
True.
I can deal with that. The mix, though, is, like, really weird.
I
never got it.
I don't understand.
Yeah, but yes. Go on.
I had Thanksgiving dinner yesterday.
Oh, okay.
Oh, you so started already.
You started already.
Wow.
Yeah, so but because everyone in my family has like different dates for individual stuff, sure. So
whatever works, right?
Yeah. It's too bad though. I've always wanted to have Thanksgiving dinner with like monkeys crawling on the ceiling or something like that. It'd be kind of fun.
What?
Yes. Dude, ask me how that would happen. I just said that. Moving on. So, guys, I would like to start this interview by asking you about this. What does this mean to you?
Oh my god. What card is this? It's from M11, 2-2. Just like, this is standard. This is not a very good card.
Common. 2-2 for 2, not so great.
Yeah.
It's a cat, though. Cat's pretty awesome.
Yeah, you can make some kind of cat deck. We really like Magic the Gathering. Okay, so I guess Jeff and Zach...
I started a long time ago, and then me and Zach played our drummer. And then we were playing at Joe's house, and then he was like...
No, wait.
What is that?
You got Mel into it first.
Oh, I got Mel into it,
So
yeah.
Mel, Jeff, and Zach played for a while. There's this period of time. And I kind of was like holding... Like, even our other friends were joining, and I was kind of like, I'm not going to get into this. This is like, because they would... When you play this game... You're locked in. Like, you play this game forever. Like,
and if you don't play the game, you're like, I don't understand anything.
Yeah, you don't understand.
I don't know what's going on here.
And, like, they would play, and the rest of our friends wouldn't do anything. I'm like, I don't want to get into that. And then one day, I'm like, I kind of gave in, and I played. And I don't know, like, what I was doing, but I won my first game against Mel. Because Jeff and Zach just kind of was like, do this. Combo, I don't know, and I was hooked on it ever since, and then I got super into it, like, more into it than everyone.
Yeah.
And then,
Joe's the official Magic addict.
Yeah, so we kind of were all into it for a while. We would play together till, like, super late at night, because, like I said, you're in the game, I don't know.
In fact.
We do, like, teams and stuff. Like,
we did our tour going up to Montreal in, what, July?
Yeah.
And it's like, we drove up to Montreal for 6 hours, played the show, drove back to Ottawa for like another 3 hours. It was like, what, 2 a.m.?
Yeah. And
we just like played Magic until like 5 a.m.
One of the guys, one of the bands we played with, their merch guy played Magic, and their drummer of Trespassers, they played Magic. So that kind of got us back in. But basically, like, yeah, we were super intense for a while. I used to go to standard tournaments, and we went to like Pro Tour Qualifier once and like this other big money tournament.
Nice.
And then, if you know the game, standard phases out. So we kind of, like, all lost interest for a while, because it's kind of hard, because the cards change. I don't know, you have to... If you know the game, you understand what we're talking about, I feel. But now we're, like, kind of casually back into it. Like, we'll still enjoy playing every once in a while, but it wasn't, like, how when we first started, we would just play all of us four. It really brought us together, I feel, you know? Like, the four of us.
Yeah?
Yeah, we played a lot, so it's good. Had some good teams games.
Hmm.
It's a good game, though. If you don't play it, you should play it, but also money.
Yeah.
The cards cost a lot of money sometimes, if you want to be, like, intense.
Yeah, they do. I'm more of a Yu-Gi-Oh card guy, and I can attest to that.
You know that, like...
Even more expensive.
Yeah, I think it is more expensive.
I heard, like, some cards are just so, like, expensive.
Fun fact, I actually had a card from that my cousin got me to pack one day.
Yeah.
Apparently it's like $30 now. It's like $30
nice.
Bucks on
wow,
like online.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Sell that.
For sure.
Yeah.
It's hard though. Sometimes you're like, oh, I kind of want this card.
Magic, it's like common, uncommon, rare, and then like there's one above mid.
Yeah.
Isn't Yu-Gi-Oh! There's super rare and like super mega awesome rare.
Sort of there's
like ultra rare.
There's
like
common, uncommon, rare. Then yes, there's ultra. Then there's also foil. Then there's also variants. It gets kind
of
ridiculous.
Yeah, there's just like a bunch of different crazy ones. That'd be cool. I don't know. I don't know anything about Yu-Gi-Oh! But I heard it gets pretty crazy.
Oh yes. Now, another thing I have for you gentlemen.
Whoa, look at this hidden stuff under the couch.
Oh, Zach's not here.
Oh, Zach is not here. Yeah. But I do love Zelda. You kind of love Zelda.
Okay.
This is awesome. This is really cool. This is like a Choose Your Own Adventure book. Oh, it's a comic.
Oh, do you read it the other way?
Yeah, it's. I think it's a,
so,
it's a manga.
Manga stuff.
I guess I don't... No, I don't want... I haven't played...
Legend of Zelda Majora's Mask?
Yes.
So those who have not seen... This is one of the best Zeldas. If Zach was here, I think he would say it's his favorite Zelda. Or maybe Ocarina of Time. I don't really know.
I don't know. It's a toss-up really for everyone, I feel like, with those two.
For me, I think this is my favorite Zelda.
This one's underappreciated. Everyone talks about Ocarina of Time, like, all the best, but...
Majora's Mask is definitely my first Zelda, actually. I played for the 64. I was, like, 10 years old. And I actually haven't really played the GameCube ones. You played Wind Waker, right?
Okay, so the only Zelda I played more than probably 10% of, because I'm the kind of person who gets stuck on adventure games and then puts them off for like 4 months and then comes back, gets stuck again, puts them off for like 5 months. I can't go through that beginning stage. But I played a lot of Wind Waker, and then I got stuck and then I stopped playing. And then I lent the game to someone.
Yeah.
So I really liked awesome, it though, because really cool. It was hard for me to get into it. I have Ocarina like Master Quest, and I started it, and I'm like, I can't, I want like cool stuff like, right now, but it's just like, it's a hard grind, I feel, in the beginning stages.
Yeah,
like,
sure.
Just picking up things, tutorial stuff, I don't know.
If you're bad.
Yeah, if you're bad at the game.
But yeah, like, I really love this game. Zach is here, he is like the Zelda fanatic. Favorite games of all time.
He knows how to play like all the songs.
He loves all.
Nice.
Yeah, it's cool. Loves all the Zeldas and stuff. Yeah. So
my students ask me to learn Zelda songs on guitar. Which is
yeah,
awesome.
It's cool that like young kids still play. Didn't you say
Zelda got you into like music in a way? Like,
yeah. Well, yeah, because they're actually so music based, which is cool. Especially Majora's Mask.
I remember you telling me
Ocarina
like
of Time.
Like playing your Ocarina, like when you're a child, you're like, oh my gosh, it's like having like a power or something.
Yeah,
like
it's
that.
Cool, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's cool. These games are really cool. Especially this one, because like, depending on what you change into, you play different instruments.
Yeah.
So like, you can play, if you turn to the Zora, you play guitar.
Yeah.
It's really cool.
I heard, and there's like a band in it, isn't there like a...
Yeah, this song, yeah, you're right. Yeah, this game, part of the story is like you create a band and stuff, which is really cool.
Whoa.
Yeah.
So relatable.
Yeah. Cool. It's actually right. I totally forgot about that, but definitely a big part.
Very cool.
Thanks.
Have you played Majora's Mask?
Yes, actually. I played.
Or have you only read the book?
No, I
didn't
know
this existed. This is like crazy.
I played through halfway through Majora's Mask. I finished Wind Waker. I finished Twilight Princess.
Nice.
Almost finished Ocarina of Time. And I'm working. And I finished Link to the Past.
Yeah.
I'm working on Link's Awakening and the first Zelda game as well.
True. So you're well read. Nice.
Yeah.
Zelda's amazing.
It is. And I don't even play it, but I understand.
Yeah. I mostly played like the Game Boy ones and like the N64 ones.
Nice.
So yeah, like Link's Awakening, Oracle of Ages Seasons, and like Majora's Mask, Ocarina of Time. I haven't played Zelda 1, but I heard that's way different.
Yeah.
It's like side-scroller, right? Oh yeah, Zach's played it, yeah.
You need it. Some people call it a guide game. It's confusing.
Yeah.
To say the least.
Yeah. It doesn't tell you what to do.
Sometimes it makes me kind of wish Navi was in everything. Okay. Now, my next question for you guys is this. It's for Joe. Telecasters.
I don't think I liked it. I remember, okay, so that red Telecaster I have. I was in grade 8. I played guitar for like barely 2 years. And I would just look online, musicians' friends, just, like, at guitars and stuff, and I was like, oh, cool, this guitar looks so cool. And then I found that Telecaster, and I'm like, I want this guitar. Didn't know, like, anything about guitars. I'm just like, yeah, I want this one, because it's red, and it looks really cool. And then I kind of went on a search for it, like, around Ontario, I guess, in a way, like, with my parents. It didn't have it at the Long McQuaid in Brampton. We checked out Toronto, like, Steve's and thing, and then we figured out it was in the Scarborough location, and we just ordered it to the Brampton one, and I saved up a bunch of money somehow. Like, I was in grade 8, I don't know how I got money, but just through, like, birthdays and Christmas and stuff, and I bought that guitar with my own money, and my mom's like, do you want to buy this guitar? Because it's an expensive guitar, it's like a Fender American Telecaster, and I was like, yeah, and, like, I just, like, when I saw it, it was super shiny, and I'm like, oh, man, like, I loved it, but, like, I didn't know anything. Mm. And then...
But it's shiny.
I got it, and I'm like, wow, this is actually, like, as I got better at guitar, because I was kind of one of those kids who had a guitar that was too good for him for a while, I'm like, oh, this is actually, like, a really good guitar. Like, it kind of did exactly what I wanted to do at the time, and later I figured out that Kenny, like, from Onin, used the same one, and I still really like that guitar, but now it's, like, it's kind of old, and it's kind of has, like, fret wear, and the pickups are kind of dying, so it needs a bit of an overhaul, but it's an awesome guitar. Telecasters look really cool. My Telecaster is not, like, a traditional one, though. It has two humbucker pickups. So, I did know that when I was buying a new guitar, I was recommended the Les Paul Studio a lot, which I like, which also had two humbuckers, but this one was cheaper and had two humbuckers, so it's, like, similar sound. For a cheaper price, and it looked really cool. It was really shiny. Like, when I first got it, you don't understand. I don't think anyone... a couple people have seen it when I first got it, and it was super shiny, and then it got ruined. But I love that guitar. And Telecasters in general, like, I'm not, like, oh, Telecaster guy. But I like the guitar, so... Hmm. Yeah.
Very cool.
Thanks. I don't know. Is that what you... I don't know. Telecaster. Yeah, it's mainly that Telecaster. It's not, like, Telecaster. That one has a special place in my heart.
Well, I mean, Wilco Johnson's favorite guitar is basically the same Telecaster you have from the 1960s.
Yeah.
And that Telecaster it sounds pretty good, so...
Yeah. I don't know who that is, but... Sorry. I'm sure it's a great guitar. You know who that is? Okay, I expose you too.
Dr. Feelgood, Pub Rock, never mind. Okay, now my next question is this. Randy River, Final Cut 08.
Oh, what show was that?
Oh, are those like the Supernova?
Yes.
Battle of the Bands things we used to play. Which one was that, though? That was their sponsor, Randy River?
Yes.
Okay, so I guess when we started the band...
Where was that show, do you know?
Fortunately, the information is not in here. Mm.
Okay, so our first few shows, yeah, were with this company. Randy River. Because, you know, like, we're in high school. Final Cut. I don't know which one that was.
Yeah, I'm trying to think.
But,
I do, like, vividly remember... the name of the series.
Well, we're in high school, it was like hard, I don't know, we didn't really know a lot of places to get shows, and we found out about it, and it, you know, it was okay, like, they had some fun shows at the time. There were like a billion bands at every single show.
Yeah.
Really annoying.
Yeah, those days, like...
And all the bands were like completely different genres.
It's like, so when you're starting out, like, you just want to play a lot of shows.
Yeah, so we just kind of took whatever we could get.
But definitely, like, those companies, like, abuse bands that just want to play a lot of shows,
right? Yeah, for sure.
Because, like, I mean, yeah, like, for one show, they'll have, like, 10 bands.
Yeah, and then, like, your set time's not decided till day of, so it's like, oh, wait. You have to sell tickets. You actually have to play at 4 p.m. So, yeah. Oh, no, you have to play at 12 a.m.
It was actually really bad. I don't know if it's still that bad. Like, I don't know if companies still do that. I know Supernova's dead now.
It still exists to an extent.
Yeah, like, there are promoters that are, like, similar, but...
Like, to get started, you can do it, like, once or twice. I think we've only played a total of 8 shows, and by the end of it, we kind of just stopped caring about selling tickets. We're just like, oh.
Yeah.
No. Like, first few, it was like, first show, tell everyone we know. Like, got so many people out. Like, we probably made them so much money just because we're just like, yeah, first show, yeah. First show. And then it was a fun show.
Yeah.
There was a lot of people.
Yeah.
And then the cool. Second show we played was really funny because all of our friends' bands started playing these shows like in our high school. And then one band didn't care and they just gave away, they put the show on, then they dropped it and they gave away all their tickets for free. So a ton of people were there. Like, it reached capacity because all the bands sold like a ton of tickets. This was All Stars in Brampton, and these guys gave away a ton for free. So people were waiting at the door.
That's actually crazy.
Yeah, that was awesome. And then we played a couple Toronto shows. Eventually, we actually, you know what though? We did make some money through Supernova. Like, they were kind enough to eventually, like, give us, like, part of our ticket money that we should have had anyways back. But, like, we got that for a while. And then I just remember we played one show with them in Toronto. And we were first because we didn't sell any tickets. And we played to no one until, like, our last few songs. And that was, like, our last show. And we're just like, okay, we're done with this. Like, we don't need this anymore. But, I don't know. I just remember, like, that show being, like, a turning point. But the worst shows they had were these ones at Sound Academy. It was like, oh yeah, you made the finals to this Battle of the Bands thing, and you're going to play at the Sound Academy. We're like, hype, Sound Academy, man, Sound Academy. And like our couple of friends were playing too. Oh, but wait, there's two stages. Wait, what? I've been to the Sound Academy. There's only one stage. They're like, yeah, if you sell lots of tickets, get a good time, you could have a time on the big stage. Cool. Or, if not, you can play on this little stage we set up in the back and put a curtain on. And I'm like, okay. So, and you had to, like, be crazy and, like, have your parents buy, like, 100 tickets to get the big stage.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
We sold, like, I mean, a decent amount, and we would still play on the small stage.
Yeah.
And then I was like, wow, this is the worst. Like, you can hear the other band yeah, playing
we can sell
right
a
now.
Decent amount of tickets, which is pretty awesome.
Yeah, back in the day, like, everyone used to come see us. And then as we got better as a band, people... I don't know. I guess because you're younger, you're in high school.
Yeah.
It's just like something to do, and now no one cares because you're old. You know?
The problem with those shows, it like wears people down. Like, you sell tickets to them all the time.
Yeah. You feel like a bad person. The tickets were expensive. There's lots of bands.
So, like, to do that too much, like, it's like, not that cool.
You can do it, like, once or twice if you have no other options, but try to... I think the best thing, like, I kind of just wish when we were younger we were putting on more of our own shows.
Yeah. It's just so intimidating. Because
it's actually really easy to rent out a bar.
Really,
but, you just don't know that when you're younger.
Yeah.
And, we were in, like... high school, we were grade 11, we were 15, 16, so it made sense at the time, and I don't regret, like, I mean, I kind of regret some of them, but it was a good learning experience, and they were a lot of fun for us, so, yeah, but, you know, if you are, like, seeing this and you're a young band, try to just put on your own shows. You can do a couple of those to kind of meet other bands, because, I mean, you might not know as many other bands in your scene, but, like, don't rely completely on those types of shows and just explore your options. It gets easier when you're 19, I'll tell you that, so.
Very cool. Well, not cool, bittersweet, I should say. Bittersweet. Alright, now, my next question for you guys is Ribfest.
Ribfest. Mm. So, I don't know, I just saw, like, a post. Like, I literally, I kind of filtered this out. I remember there's this one, this is not related, but there was one year where I responded to, like, every ad on Kijiji, like, looking for a band. Usually, like, any opportunity looking for a band, I'll find it. So, someone posted about bands looking to play Ribfest, and I submitted, and we had to do, like, an audition. It was really weird. Like, for our style of band, it was kind of weird to do, but...
Oh, I totally forgot we did.
Yeah, so we got chosen to play,
and
the guy really liked us, and, you know, he called us back to play again, so it was a fun time. Like, we play on this, like, tent outside, and there's people watching us, and it's really not, like, the right scene, I think, for our music, but, like...
It's cool, though.
It's still fun, and we just,
there's, like a lot of people there, and
are into it, and they'll watch it, and it's a fun event, so it's, like... Yeah. Might as well play. Like, what's the cool thing about being in a band is you can go to things you would already go to, but also play. So it's like, oh, I want to go to Ribfest. Oh, but I'm also playing Ribfest. Awesome. Two birds, one stone. That's the best. So anytime you can do two things at once, just do it.
Awesome.
Yeah.
You guys eat a lot of ribs?
Okay, so the first time we went, we had only two types. The second time, we were smart. And we brought a couple people with us, and we're like, okay, get different places, and then we traded. So I think we had a good amount.
Yeah, I was so full.
It was a lot. So
yeah, ribs are the best.
They're not the best, but they're really good.
Luke Grimm's really good.
It's true, they're not the best.
Ribs.
Yeah, definitely try out a rib fest, though. Like, the ribs there are, like...
Yeah, the first time we went, it was, like, surprisingly really cool.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people, a lot of fun. It's, like, really... It's, like, by the... It's, like, by the... What, the lakefront?
Yeah, the one there is the Burlington one. It's, like, by the waterfront. It's really nice. It's apparently Canada's largest rib fest. So if you're going to go check out one, it would be the one to go to. Plus, apparently, we play every year now.
Yeah.
2 years in a row, so... There's also, like, two other big stages with, like, U2 cover bands and stuff.
U2 cover bands at Ribfest.
Yeah. Like, they have, like, more, like, dad rock and, like, mom rock stuff. But the tent that we played at was, like, this music school / studio. And they try to bring in a lot of upcoming bands, which is cool. So respect to that. But the other, like, big stages, they have, like, cover bands, which is, like, fun.
I'm actually curious, which era you two, though?
I don't know. I can't remember. It was not this year I saw one.
Yeah,
but the year before. It was good, though. It was cute. I liked it. I don't know. Just check it out. See for yourself.
I have to check this out. I'm curious. Okay. Now, one big birthday.
Oh. When did I start doing the birthday shows? I think we've only done two. Mine and Zach's birthdays are really close together. So March 14th, March 18th. And we have a lot of the same friends. And you know, you want to do something with all your friends, but you kind of can't do certain things because you're like, wait, that's too many people. You know, like when you start inviting one person and that means you have to invite this person because they're on the same friend level.
Mm-hmm.
Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Okay. So we have a lot of close friends. And I was like, oh, we should just throw a show. You know, and we can get, like, some of our favorite bands to play, and it'll be really chill. So we did that 2 years ago, at All-Stars, and it went really well. And I had a cool idea where to get cheaper cover charge, you have to make me and Zach a homemade birthday card, because I love homemade birthday cards. Like, they're awesome, and a lot of people did, like, cool stuff, and, you know, it was a lot of fun. First show went really well. We played with, I think... Cardinal Dream, which was a new band we took on. We always, like, bring in one new band and then play with, like, two friends' bands. And then Stockholm Siesta and Orca, which are, like, all our good friends in Brampton. Then the next show, we're like, okay, we tried to get the date close to mine and Zach's birthday, but it ended up being really late in March, and it was really close to Mel's birthday, which is 2 weeks from mine. So we're like, okay, triple birthday show. Now we can triple guilt people into coming. Because, you know, like, people are like, oh, you're not coming to my birthday? So, I don't know, whatever. But we ended up putting on the show, and it was Stockholm, Huge Cosmic, and we brought in Pretty Odd, because we played with them so long ago.
Yeah.
And then our friend was like, oh, they're really good, you gotta see them now. I'm like, okay, I'm just gonna have them play my birthday show. So, that was really cool. And that show was weird, because... the first show was, like, everyone was coming because it was, like, our birthday. The second show, just a ton of people came. Like, a lot of people I didn't know. Didn't get as many homemade birthday cards, but there were more people there. So it was just, the word got out, I guess. So that was cool. And, it was a lot of fun. So the birthday shows are a lot of fun. I'll probably do them every year because we can get, like, our friends' bands to play.
Where do you want to do it next year?
I'll probably keep in Brampton. Yeah.
Probably not so many, or...
Maybe, I don't know. I like Ellen's, but it's just, you have to set up everything yourself.
Yeah, that's the big thing, is, like, the sound is not great there.
Yeah, like, the last birthday show, I had to, like, be sound guy and doorman, so it wasn't, like, that fun. We did have balloons. No, it was a lot of fun, but I'm saying it was, like, also work, so
yeah.
I guess next year would be nice to kind of get people in charge of that stuff, at least.
Yeah, mm-hmm. We can, like, get the sound better somehow, you know?
Yeah.
It's the biggest
thing. We'll see.
Hmm.
But yeah, it's fun.
That's the birthday show.
I saw pictures of those balloons, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was pretty fun time.
Awesome. Very cool.
Thanks.
Triple birthdays.
Yeah. It's extra birthday power.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Jeff, my next question is for you. Twitter opinions.
Sorry?
Twitter opinions.
Yeah, you're pretty,
Twitter opinions.
Yeah, you tweet a lot of reviews of things on Twitter, I notice.
I do sometimes. I don't know. When I started using Twitter, I, like, didn't know what it was for. And now I'm like, I have this thought, but I have no one to say it to, so I'm just gonna...
Jeff gets lonely.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know. What do I tweet about?
You tweet a lot of, like, movie reviews.
Oh, I tweet some, like, yeah,
and then you tweet about things being like South Park.
Yes.
Like, real life things, like, oh, this is like South Park. It's true. It's actually so true. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, I don't know.
I find it funny when he does it.
Yeah.
I look at him, I'm like, God, Jeff, who are you talking to?
I don't have any strong opinions on that. I just, sometimes when I'm bored, I just tweet. So follow me. See my weird tweets.
What's your Twitter?
Yeah, not Jeff Lee.
Not Jeff Lee.
Yeah.
It's a more recent thing, I feel like.
I think it's a more recent thing. Yeah. Because definitely, when I started using Twitter, I didn't use it.
I don't even know what your original tweets were like.
I don't think I had any.
But it's fun. If you like, you know, like, solid movie reviews in, like, 140 characters, follow Jeff.
Yeah.
That's why I tune in every day. Alright, let's see. Now, my next question is what does this mean to you guys?
Oh my god.
Super Nintendo?
Ready.
What game?
F-Zero.
Ooh,
cool.
Okay, I'm a fraud. I haven't played F-Zero.
I
only know about Captain Falcon.
Have I played this one? I don't think I've played the Super Nintendo one.
I didn't have a Super Nintendo, or my
either.
Grandma, or my, you know, like, my family
really
didn't
cool.
have a Super Nintendo.
You have a Super Nintendo?
I had Nintendo.
Nice.
Well, I didn't have Nintendo, but, like, in my grandparents, aunts, and stuff.
Like, I don't have a Super Nintendo, but I used to play Super Nintendo, like, emulators.
Nice.
Computer and stuff like that.
I think Zach played F-Zero.
That's a Zach
question.
Yeah, this is definitely a Zach question, because I'm pretty sure he played F-Zero and he probably loved it. But I really like Super Nintendo, but, like, some of the best games are on it. Yeah, my favorite game, Chrono Trigger, is off of Super Nintendo.
Chrono Trigger is amazing.
Yeah, it's off of Super Nintendo. If this was Chrono Trigger, my mind would have been blown because it's worth like $200. Yeah, Earthbound's on Super Nintendo. A lot of really cool games. Final Fantasy VI? Yeah. Cool.
You see, this leads into my main question. You guys have
main
a...
question.
Interesting relationship with video games.
Yeah,
we do.
Playing them, talking about them. I've known some of the members of New Design have written about video games.
Yeah,
you guys have attended shows featuring video games,
for
tournaments.
Sure.
Explain your relationship to video games and explain that.
Okay, so yeah, Mel works for the Score, actually.
For esports.
And they do, like, data for, like, esports tournaments and stuff.
So
like
basically
that.
Like, okay, so you know the Score app for sports, and it's like, oh, Montreal scored like a goal, and it tells you there's an esports app for like all like games like Counter Strike,
like
Dota,
League,
and, like,
and
Mel
like
basically reports what happens in those games, and
so
then the esports
cool.
app updates you.
And Zach, he does
Zach runs
he does like local Smash tournaments and stuff like that.
Oh.
Yeah.
He works for a company called EMG.
Even Matchup Gaming, they have a YouTube channel and they feature Smash content, so they'll stream tournaments, they'll do like highlight videos for all Smash games, like 64, Melee, Brawl, and Smash 4. I don't know, it's cool because everyone I feel like has like a different background in gaming.
Yeah, like,
so
like those two are pretty connected into that sort of thing.
Yeah, so...
For me, like, I've played games forever and like they've always been bigger than movies, bigger than TV shows for me, at least. And they've just, like, influenced everything I've done. And, yeah, I don't know.
I play everything. Like, computer games, console games.
Every system.
The funny thing that we'll do, our friend group, and I kind of hate it because I don't like it as much all the time, is they'll get together and play a one-player game.
Yes.
And everyone will watch. Like, five people, or, like, four people, where you could be playing this multiplayer game. And everyone will watch Jeff play, like, like, they'll do it with games that make sense, like Last of Us, fun to watch, Drake's Fortune, fun to watch, Heavy Rain, fun to watch, Metal Gear, fun to watch, like, interesting stories and cutscenes, but they'll also do it with, like, really, like, no interesting cutscenes. Like, I don't know, they'll watch someone play Zelda for, like, you know, like, go through the quests in Zelda. And I'm like, that's not, like, a...
A little bit less. I feel like I don't really remember doing that.
Well, you guys did it with some boring, like, boring to watch games. They've
definitely done boring games.
Yeah.
Probably. Yeah.
So, and they've watched, like, I think they've watched
each other play... This was, like, before, like, Twitch and, like,
yeah,
watching Let's Plays and stuff.
Yeah.
That's pretty much what we did.
Yeah, and they would watch just, like, different people play the same game. Like, yeah, it's like they already saw the game
beat it.
But it was like, oh, no, I want to see our friend Franco beat this game.
Yeah, yeah.
So...
we play, like, the, like, all those, like, scary games and stuff like that.
Yeah.
That's cool. We'll probably do that for Halloween.
But...
Like, I don't know if you've heard of Amnesia or any of the stuff like that.
No,
it's like you're, like, stuck in, like, a haunted mansion.
He spends, like, too much time on Steam.
There's, like, a guy, like, chasing you, but you, like, don't know. It's, like, a monster and stuff. It's cool.
But, yeah, so Jeff plays everything. Zach plays everything. Mel plays... Like, she started playing a lot more.
Dota.
Yeah.
And then Jeff, we got her to play some of
So Jeff
games.
And Mel Dota, and then me and Zach, we play Smash competitively, like Melee.
Yeah.
I'm the type of person with video games. I like, like, kind of like repetitive things and, like, getting really good at something.
Yeah.
I'm really good
at Tetris. It looks to commit to one thing.
Really good at Tetris, really good at Guitar Hero, really good. Okay, I want to say I was good at Melee, but the more you play the game and the better you get at the game, you realize how... There's too many levels and skills. So I'm, like, really good compared to an average person. But in the tournament scene, I'm, like, I don't know, like, middle of the pack. Like, it's such a hard game. Like, the top players are so good, you don't understand. But,
There's a huge Smash Bros. Melee scene.
Yeah, competitive. Yeah, and then me and Zach are heavily involved in it.
Play for, like, thousands of dollars, and, like, it's super popular in North America.
So...
I think these guys went to a tournament in...
We went to this tournament called the Big House.
States?
We went to Apex, too. Like, we try to go to... And there's, like, bigger tournaments locally. Like, Zach's hosted some of the biggest Smash Bros. Tournaments here.
Yeah, which is pretty crazy.
And we try to go out and just play. It's a pretty, like, close-knit community too, like, a lot of people know each other. It's really fun if you like the game and you want to get good at it. It's you should try going out. It's a fun thing to be a part of, because it's a real life community where everyone comes together just because they love Smash Bros. Melee.
Yeah, we're all
the best game ever,
closely connected into the gaming universe.
Yeah,
which is pretty cool.
I'm not, like, a huge gamer compared to everyone else.
Yeah.
I just play, like, one game super seriously.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, video games are cool. As a kid, I used to play a lot of video games too.
Mm.
I don't know. They're always going to be great. I appreciate them. Maybe we play too much video games. It's a bit.
Hey, you can never play too much video games.
Exactly.
It's true.
I never play too much. Speaking of games as well, Jeff, you were involved with the creation of a board game.
I was.
Oh, that's the other thing we really like. We really like board games.
Yeah. We got into board games, like...
More recently.
4 or 5 years ago.
Yeah. They're, like...
And then, like, we just, like, got crazy and just, like, bought a billion of them.
Yeah, among, like, our friends, me and Jeff, we have, like, a good solid collection of, like, interesting stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I did copy editing for a game called Faith. It's by a cool company from the UK called Burning Games. And I just found them on Kickstarter, started talking to them because they're mostly Spanish-based. So I was reading through the rulebook, and, you know, there's, like, grammar errors or, like, things could be more clear. Especially in a board game, you need the rules to be super clear. You need to know how to say things. Otherwise, it's just, like, doesn't make
sense. Yeah, we've had some board games, and the rules are poorly translated, and
you're
kind of, like, okay, what do you do in this situation?
Like, what are you exactly
telling me?
Look at the
rules. What? Like, that's so vague.
Yeah. So I feel like I have a good understanding of how all of that works. So then I just approached them. I sent them an email. And turns out they were looking for a copy editor. So I talked to them, and then we started working together.
Internet.
And it was really awesome. Yeah, I worked just online.
He
and it looks really good.
He edited board games from his house, just at his own...
Yeah.
Leisure, and they paid him. It was crazy.
Yeah.
Dream job. It was the dream. Yeah.
So, yeah, hopefully it leads to more things, but it looks really good.
Yeah, the game looks cool.
Check it out, Burning Games, Faith. And, yeah, they did a great job. So, I'm really excited about it.
Very cool.
Yeah. Thank you.
Very cool. Speaking of copywriting or copy editing, you also tweeted back to an earlier question. You also tweeted out about Mad Men.
Mad Men? Yeah.
Mad Men once, so.
Okay, so I started watching Mad Men because I applied to an advertising copywriting program in Humber, and I really didn't know what it was. I'm pretty sure most people don't know what it was.
So you watched Mad Men?
Yeah, so Mad Men was like my education. It's like, what is this thing? Because I went to like the interview and like everyone talked about Mad Men there, and I was like,
oh, that's why like, you were there and you couldn't relate, and you're like, I was like, you gotta go home and watch Mad Men.
Yeah, and I was like, okay, I guess I should watch this.
Take place in like the 50s though or something?
Yeah, that's...
So it's kind of dated.
Yeah. 60s. Well, that's like when advertising going, right?
True. Okay.
But yeah, advertising copywriting is basically writing copy for...
Now I gotta watch Mad Men.
...businesses to consumers. So it's like any copy that people would see on like anything, like billboards... magazines, stuff like that. So it's a lot more about writing less words, but in such a way that it evokes emotions from other people. So there's a bit of like psychology and like anthropology behind it, which is kind of interesting. So I don't know. I'm in that program now. And yeah, it's pretty cool. And I think it'll be interesting, so I don't know. But Mad Men, I started watching it, yeah, in July, and it's actually really cool. It's like, have you seen it?
It's one of my favorite shows.
It's like, oh, really? It starts super slow, like and actually it's like slow throughout. It's like not,
yeah, it doesn't pick up.
It like
it has bursts of
It's the thing is like it's like very slice of life. It's like daily life rather than like overarching crazy story. Oh my god, what happens next, you know? Just like you watch it, it's just like, okay, that's cool. But the thing is, like, it's well written. There's like a lot of symbolism and stuff behind it, because like random stuff will happen. They'll be like talking in an elevator, and then one guy will talk about like this crazy book that he read yesterday, and it's like Ayn Rand's like something, and you're like, why is this happening? Right? It's like, this doesn't make any sense. But there's a lot of that, and okay. It's like it's interesting when you think about it.
I'll have to watch it.
So it's definitely weird, and it's like if you watch it and you don't really think about it, it's like I don't know why anything's happening, because like they're just talking about random stuff all the time.
Yeah.
But I don't know. It's cool. It's well written. I haven't finished yet, so I'm on like season 6.
I won't spoil it for you. All
right. Yeah. Is it like done? The show's complete.
I think it's done. Yeah.
Okay. I finished
like earlier this year.
I like
year.
When shows are done. Yeah. Because then I'm like, all right, I have an end goal. I'm not waiting on.
Yeah. I definitely gotta finish it. So.
Yeah. Very cool. Just don't turn into a Don Draper on us.
Yeah. Hopefully. Don't get that reference. he's not in. He doesn't know.
Or Roger Sterling, actually, for that matter. Moving on. Alright. Sonic Evolution.
Zach? Zach thing?
That's very much a Zach question. He has very strong opinions about Sonic.
Is it bad?
Is Sonic Evolution a game?
No.
Are you just talking
a show?
Actually, no. This isn't about Sonic the Hedgehog.
You
mean like our sound?
I've noticed,
that's not a Zach question.
Yeah.
I've noticed that your sound has evolved over the years. On your first EP, your sound was more... For lack of better phrasing, best I could describe it is, I found it to be more similar in many ways to, say, mid-2000s post-hardcore. The most post-hardcore in many ways, like Brand New, even Fryce, for example.
Yeah.
Your current sound, as I observed, is a bit more it's a bit more ambient, a bit more like an autumn breeze. Well, all your songs are kind of like an autumn breeze in my ears.
That's
to be
beautiful.
Honest with you. Explain
write
how
that
your
on our albums.
Yeah, in our bio.
Explain how your sound has evolved from more of a from such a more abrasive sound to more of a more ambient sound as
yeah.
it is now.
Yeah.
Okay.
When we started out, I think we didn't really know where we were going. I mean, obviously, our influences are so different, right?
Yeah, we've been a band for a long time.
Yeah, and I think that's a huge part of the reason
so,
why it's so different.
Yeah.
Like, when we started, like, I was very, like, Maiden heavy, like, metal. You guys were, like, more, like, pop rocky.
So, I think about, like, okay, like, back to what we used to listen to, because,
yeah.
I mean, being in a band for a while and listening to so much music. So, we're in high school. We started the band. I was into bands, like, either like a lot of alt rock, like Smashing Pumpkins, I don't know, that like 90s kind of stuff, and like pop rock, like Fall Out Boy, Blink-182, like that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. Jeff came from like the more classic rock background. I don't know, like Guns N' Roses, Iron Maiden.
Guns N' Roses, Iron Maiden.
Yeah. Zach, it was in a similar realm, like Paramore, Fall Out Boy, and then Mel, me and Mel kind of listen to the same things. I don't know, and then like Rise Against Lux on Fire and like a bit of Monin.
Yeah.
But you kind of just take the things you like about those genres. So like, I think about Smashing Pumpkins, they're a very dynamic band. You think about like a lot of classic rock, it has a lot of good like instrumental guitar work.
Yeah.
So we
just
would
like
kinda,
catchy riffs, layers, yeah, stuff like that.
And then like we think about pop rock, there's like catchy vocals. So you kind of take the things you like with those genres and you start making your own music. And
yeah, when we started, it was like that idea, but in a more
yeah, so
hard rock kind of setting.
Yeah, like our first few songs yeah. had lots of guitar solos. They're still pretty ambient. Like we did the clean heavy thing that like Pumpkins do like quite a bit.
Yeah.
We had a couple more like straight up beat songs like that didn't really do that. So I don't know. We wrote like about like
this
10...
is more power chordy stuff too.
Yeah, like yeah, because I guess we're still like learning the instruments too.
Yeah.
Zach was still like probably the newest. Zach and Mel were newer at their instruments than me and Jeff. So our guitar work was always a bit. No offense. Our guitar work is always a bit stronger than the rest of our stuff. And with vocals, it was kind of like Jeff's best singer. You got it, Jeff. Like, out of us. Not that he was a singer, per se. It's just like, you can sing better than me, Zach, and Mel. So
yeah.
We kind of forced that upon you. So, I don't know. We started writing these songs. We get to... So, the EP is a collection of maybe 6 songs out of maybe 20, 25. From after of like 3 years of writing. The first song, the oldest song on the EP is a song that we kind of argued against putting on called Burn Up the Sky.
Mm-hmm.
Which is like a very straightforward rock song with back-to-back guitar solos. It's pretty heavy throughout, but it's like a well-structured song. Like, people liked it when we played it. Then there's NCIX, which was, name doesn't make any sense. When we wrote it, it really felt like, wow, this is a really good song. It was just really well put together. It was dynamic. It was pretty straightforward. Then, I don't know, we wrote a couple other songs. What's weird about the band, so I think about the music I listen to now, like a lot of post-rock, math rock, emo rock, like, I don't know. Like, Jeff also listens to a lot of acoustic stuff. It's like more specific genres. So, like, it's more, I think about the stuff we liked about the basic genres we used to listen to, and it's more that, like, centralized. So,
mm-hmm.
like, that kind of came to our music more. I remember not knowing what post-rock was when we made Omnisphere 2, which was an instrumental, like, post-rock song, or the ending of Failure. Like, the ending of Failure by Design, people would say it sounded like Explosions in the Sky. Like, never listened to Explosions in the Sky.
Yeah.
People would give us Brand New comparisons. I never listened to Brand New at the time. And then I listened to these bands, I'm like, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Like, we just didn't know the bands that we wanted to sound like.
It's weird. Because,
yeah.
like, yeah, that's sort of what we wanted to sound like. But we didn't really know there were genres.
Yeah, it was just kind of taken from what we heard in the music we liked.
Yeah, and then when we started listening to those genres, it really
yeah,
developed,
we kind of,
like, what we wanted to sound like.
Yeah, like...
I think we found, like, more of a vision that we wanted to go towards.
Yeah, I remember recording the album. Kenny helped us a lot. I mean, we're always Monin fans, and they're a big influence on our band, and they're kind of, like, in the realm we wanted to be in musically. And then Kenny showed us Moving Mountains.
Yeah.
And that kind of was like, oh my god, like, this is a thing that exists. Like, this type of music. Like, this... Because we always talked about, like, post-rock with, like, vocals that, like, people can catch on to. Like, that would be awesome. And then we're like, wow, Moving Mountains exists. So, like, that's a thing already. And then we kind of like, okay, but we still have... We still felt like we were doing our own thing enough where we're like, we're not this, but, like, we... have part of this, but we also have a lot of other things to offer. I don't know, it's just weird. I just think it's just like a mass of stuff you listen to, and
yeah.
just playing together too, like...
It, I mean, like, it's not like we just, like, sat down and was like, this is what we want to sound like. It was very natural. It was over the course of, like, 8 years, six
yeah.
years.
Yeah, like, we wrote, so...
We've written so many songs.
Yeah, like, maybe, like, 50.
So, yeah, this
and
album...
And you've only heard, like, 16.
Yeah, so like the progression is all there. It's just
yeah.
like
I think oh after
gradually we've got to that point.
Yeah,
which is cool.
Basically, I think back to, like, after the first album, too, we wrote a lot of really heavy songs. Yeah. So we're going in this really heavy, like, post-hardcore route. And then we started writing a lot of, like, really light songs. Like, just, like, kind of poppy, like, no distortion. Uh-huh. And then we're like, wait, like, what? Like, this was getting too weird. And then we kind of, like, just, like, put them more together. And we had, like, a sound in mind when we were writing the album. We're like, okay, like, once we picked out certain songs, like, we wrote Things We Can't Forget, we're like, we finished it before all these other songs we're working on. We're like, this is, like, we feel really good about the sound. Like, we want to kind of focus the album around this style of writing. Like, so we kind of would write songs, and then if they fit in with that, or we would just try to make them fit in with that. And then we picked 10 songs. Well, actually, we only had, like, 8 at the time, and we finished the other two. But we kind of wrote around the certain songs that we're feeling best about, I guess. Yeah. We take a lot of things, too. Like, a lot of our friends' bands influence us a lot, too. Like, just seeing them do different things. Like, after the album, we decided to kind of get everyone more involved on vocals. Like, one of our favorite local bands, Ellis Arma, it was really cool watching them because everyone sang. Mm-hmm. And it was just like, okay, like, we should try to all sing. Like, see what we can do. And we try to use Mel. We try to use, like, me and Zach. We try to use all of us together. So that kind of helped us shape our sound. Mm-hmm. It worked with, like, our music, I feel like, before. Also, like, we with Toe, it, like, a band we really like, it was like, oh, how can we get, like, drums more involved? Like, our old songs were very guitar driven because that was, like, the music we listened to. Mm-hmm. But hearing a band like Toe was like, wow, like, they really use the drums like this, like, we should try doing that. So it was just like taking the things we like from certain bands and trying to push them in our own way. Mm-hmm. I feel like we're less guitar driven. Not, I think our guitar stuff's really cool, but I feel like we're not as guitar driven as before.
Yeah.
I mean, it's still...
Well, that's where the whole ambient thing comes.
Yeah.
It's like more effects driven.
Yeah. We try more to like, layers. Yeah, and I was trying to think of all the instruments as like a, as more of like a texture, and then like, okay, guitar usually plays lead, bass usually holds on this, so I don't know. It's just listening to music and playing music and getting older.
Yeah.
I'll be very curious to see what you guys produce when you're 50.
Yeah. Wow, that would be interesting. I never thought that far ahead. I'm still like...
I'm very curious too. Yeah.
We haven't even... We've been not really writing. We've been writing a little bit like after the album because our goal is kind of to play a lot now. I mean, we have like a billion copies of that CD to get. Like, kind of got to get rid of them. Not a billion. But, you know, we've been writing like a couple things and it's like, oh, this is interesting. Like, I wonder where this is going. But it could... The thing is, we can't really pinpoint it right now to say, like, oh, yeah, we're doing this now. Because if we keep writing, we can totally change. Just like how after EP we wrote these songs and we didn't stick with them. So, I don't know. We'll see what happens. Hmm. It'd kind of be nice to record some of, like, those other tracks we had as B-sides, but...
Yeah. In my opinion, well, I feel like we kind of get this too, but it's like... You just keep moving forward, you know?
Yeah.
Rather than dwell on whatever B-sides.
Yeah, it's true.
Because the thing is, yeah, like, as we write, we keep changing. So I like to see where we keep
going. Yeah, and every new song you write is usually better. It's just like, oh, this song's better.
I feel like that's pretty consistent with us. Like,
yeah.
It just feels better to write a new song than to, like, go back and redo an old song.
Yeah. Both, like, albums, too, were, like, years in the works in terms of writing. Mm-hmm. So like the first one's a collection of like 2008 2011. Mm-hmm. With some songs being like on the older end, and like I think Atmosphere 2 and It's Not Down the World were the newest songs on that record, and we recorded them first, so it was kind of backwards. And then like the album we have now was like maybe 2011 to 2015. Mm-hmm. With songs like Solaris and We Broke the Sun being written maybe a bit after recording or during recording the first EP, and then songs like What We Already Knew and When We Drown and Safe Place being finished up like a month before recording. So, but it fit together.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It made sense. Actually, it made a lot of sense. Everything ended up making sense. Like with the songs, we're like, oh, this makes sense. Like musically, this makes sense lyrically. And that's really what we wanted with the album, whereas, like, the first album was, like, this song, this song, this song, this song. The next album we wanted to be, like, that didn't make any sense. But, like, just it had to, like, fit, everything had to fit together.
Yeah. We wanted it to flow, and we wanted to yeah, be thematically
everything consistent. From like the art to the lyrics to the music, I think is yeah. like
from like first song to last song.
Yeah, the order yeah. was really well thought out too, so it's cool. We're really happy with it. Listened to it way too much.
I'm very happy with it as well. I think it's a great album.
Thank you.
It's a great album, I must say. Speaking of art, I have to ask. Was the art in any way influenced by Courage the Cowardly Dog?
Okay, I finally saw
no
that, and I'm like, oh my god, it's very similar. Yes. But people kept saying that I had the idea. I just drew it like on a paper. Mm-hmm. It kind of just went, when Jeff sent the demo to When We Drown to us, we don't really usually do that, but, like, he sent the demo, I looked at the lyrics, I'm like, oh, like, this would be, I had the title in mind, and I'm like, oh, this would be a cool cover, like, it's kind of ironic, and then we gave the art, like, the idea to our artist, Dane, and I guess the way he drew it, too, like, the art style is kind of similar, but, House is on Earth. Not on the moon. The moon is in the background, so it's different. But I totally see the comparison. Yeah, did you ever look at this picture?
I did.
Yeah.
I've never heard of this.
I think I've seen the show. Yeah, I've seen it, but I never remember
I've never seen it until.
Yeah, the art style and the setting. But yeah, it's very similar. It's cool. But it's kind of like the reverse.
It's cool though. It's kind of the reverse. It's not intentional.
Yeah, it wasn't intentional though.
Hmm. Yeah.
I believe I used to watch the show a lot when I was younger. I believe there was an episode where I think the house was on like another planet or the moon.
So. Oh, really? I just remember the picture I saw. It was like the moon in the background.
Yeah, but that's the iconic image though. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, that's cool though. I don't know. It's cool. What happened to that show?
Never watched it.
Rumor has it that it ended because there was an episode that got too controversial. Well, the show was
really?
Kind of...
So yeah. Wow, that's hype.
But, like, the controversial subtly.
Yeah.
So, like, a lot of complaints were filed and...
Wow.
It was a really good show, but it was kind of twisted.
Wow, that's cool.
Yeah, I heard it was really dark.
I watched it as a child, so I probably didn't...
Yeah, I probably didn't...
Flew by my head. Yeah. Wow, that's cool. If it is, like, I want to watch it now, just to see.
Yeah.
Watch the episode with the cat, with the cat and the bunny rabbit, and the vicious dogs, and you'll see why.
Okay.
Everybody, new design.
When everything we've ever known seems so far away, as a motion, trace me back to you, and I know we mindset. I've never seen the ocean down. Run! mindset, I've never seen the ocean. Too late, mindset, I've never seen the ocean. Too late, mindset, I've never seen the ocean. Too late, mindset, I've never seen the ocean.
See, oh yes, now, my name is Franco.
Yeah, so, Franco is, like, our collective best friend as a band, I guess. Like, if you were to combine, like, all of us and pick one.
I believe his official title is Band Dad.
Yeah, he was our kind of our unofficial manager. He's just a really good guy. We like him a lot. He was Jeff and Zach's, like, long-time childhood friend, and now he's friends with all of us, and supports the band. He tries to help us in, you know, ways that he can. And we were writing that song, which we dug up on, like, we had it jammed for a while, and then we dug it, like, we put it away and forgot about it, and we dug it up again. And I think Jeff came up with this melody on his guitar, and Zach was like, oh, we should use that for vocal melody. And when we were just practicing vocals, we were just say, my name is Frank, my name is Franco. So that's what we just ended up calling the song for a really long time. So instead of, like, find your way back, it's like, my name is Frank, my name is Franco.
And actually, like, all of our songs have code names, like, when we're writing them.
They're usually just, like, sounds or things that are really easy to
say.
So
it's,
like,
it's
really
actually,
fast.
Like, really weird. Well, now it's weird because all our songs
have names. Real names. Yeah, that's weird.
So that's sort of weird for us. Yeah. Yeah, like, all our songs would have code names, like, my name is Franco, so.
Or, like, yeah, Joe's song, or, like, J song, that's what we call Jeff's songs.
What was the codename for Never Seen the Ocean? Was it J
song? I think
J song
3.
J song 3.
I don't think we codenamed it. I think we might
maybe
have. Not,
maybe we just went straight to name.
Yeah, that some of them, we were getting a bit quicker at naming songs.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, I don't know. There's, like, instrumental song, new song, new song. Like, they're not very creative. They're actually really bad.
Yeah.
Some codenames suck, like NCIX was a codename, and we're just like, I don't care.
Yeah,
there's
like,
I don't know what to call the song.
So.
Yeah. My name is Franco almost stuck, I think.
Almost, but I was pretty against it.
Yeah, I didn't want, sorry.
I didn't want that on the album.
I just didn't want a name. I know some bands have, like, names.
Well, I just
titles,
didn't, like, for the thematic. Like,
yeah, it kind of just didn't go in place.
That would be really out of place. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But Franco actually told me, because we ended up it being the title track of the album, and he's like, he was happy. He was like happy that it was the title track. Like, he's like, oh, I mean, like, I know he didn't put, like, my name's Franco, but, like, I'm glad that, like, you know, like, title track, like, he felt good about it. I'm like, oh, thank you. So, it was cool.
Yeah.
It's a good guy.
Awesome.
Hi, Franco. He'll probably watch this.
Awesome. Very awesome. Speaking of J songs, Joe, you make pop songs on the side.
Yeah, so when I was in university, I had this program called, or this class, like, digital electronic music, and we used stuff using Reason, which was, like, a lot of synths and stuff like that. So every time I was on there, I just wanted to make, like, Katy Perry-sounding pop songs. Like, I don't know. I kind of like listening to that stuff, and I made a couple, and I thought they were really catchy. I don't have Reason at home, or else I make more, but me and my friend Marco would work on some of them, too. Like, he would help me out a little bit, and he always loved them, so it made me feel pretty good about them. But they're fun. Like, I don't know, they're really easy to do. You're just like, alright, these four chords. Okay, synth melody. Bam. And then they came out pretty good, and I was like, you know what? Like, these are kind of cool. I'm going to put them on SoundCloud. And I did. And that's as far as it went. I was, like, trying to, like, do some more or trying to collaborate with people, but also, like, time and work, and I also don't have the program, so I kind of just dropped that idea. But it would have been fun.
Very cool. They are catchy indeed.
Yeah, thank you.
Jazz picks.
Oh, yeah. We both love jazz threes.
Yeah, don't play with any other pick. I don't know what started it, but it's just more
I can't remember when I switched. I feel like I can play faster with the Jazz 3, like, and better. But I actually been switching off.
Oh, yeah?
Because recording, they didn't sound as good on recording, like really subtle difference.
Yeah, true.
The other thing too is they're so close to your fingers, mm-hmm. and when we play live, like we kind of go in.
Yeah.
So like.
That's also true.
I don't know, it goes in too much, and then you end up strumming the strings with your fingers, and, like, it hurts. So I started switching to bigger picks, because I would end up strumming, and, like, it would, like, kill my nail, and, like, cut my, like, parts of my finger. Does that happen to you? There's usually blood on your guitar, like,
yeah,
sometimes.
Like, the last couple of years, no. But definitely before, I used to bleed,
yeah.
like, when we played, like,
just,
Slayers or something.
Yeah, it was just so close
I don't,
up,
it would, like,
it would
cut,
slip
cut my
back,
finger.
And... You would end up strumming
and then,
fingers.
Yeah, I would like, bleed on my guitar.
But, like, in terms of, like, if I were to, like, play a guitar for someone and try to, like, if I want to play a guitar at my best, I would have to use a Jazz 3, I think.
Yeah, I just feel way more comfortable
yeah,
with it.
Yeah, same. And Jazz 3, they're pointier than the Jazz 1s and 2s.
Yeah.
So just keep that in mind for a while. I'm like, what's the difference? They're the same size. And then I looked, and
yeah, Jazz 3s.
They're just really pointy. So Jazz 3s is the way to go.
Yeah. More control.
Yeah.
Jazz picks rock.
Yeah, very thick too. So other picks, like, they bend and stuff. It's annoying.
Ah. Terrence. You guys are an MP3. You guys late. Your latest album is an MP3 file on the interwebs.
Yeah,
How that happened. We first saw it on the site called Kingdom Leaks.
Yeah, okay. I remember, though. I don't know if this is related, but we started sharing our music on, like, the Reddit, like, the subreddit, so
math rock,
post-rock, the emo subreddit, and it was pretty well-received, and I remember one person posting, it's like, oh, this is so good, I'm gonna share this with the world, like, he said something like that, so in my mind, it's him, because
yeah.
then it, later, like, maybe the next day, it went up on a site called Kingdom Leaks, which we didn't know about, and it's a site where you can, like, just preview albums, like, download them before you buy them, and it was cool, because it was, like, the community there really liked the album.
Yeah.
And, like, we got a lot of Bandcamp sales after it. So it's like, oh, even though it was for free, like,
yeah.
you know,
good.
People
That's
supported.
Right.
So we're like, wow, like, these people never would have reached out to us. That's awesome.
Yeah. And then after that, we...
I usually, like, every week I'll just search our band and see what's happening around the internet. And I searched our
There's,
album,
like, so many torrents.
And there's so many torrents.
There's, like, maybe,
like
20
random
plus
different languages.
Links, yeah.
Like, the first,
like,
four
Russian
or five
lines,
pages
like...
were, like, different links to it. I'm like, why? Like, I was just like, well, like,
weird.
What? Like, I don't understand. And I'm like, this is actually really cool. Like,
yeah.
So, yeah. It's awesome. Like, I mean, obviously it's great when people buy your music. It's probably one of the greatest things ever. But just the fact that people are listening to it and downloading it.
Yeah,
and
I don't really see it as a bad thing.
And, yeah, like, it's cool.
Because in most cases, too, it's like, wouldn't really make sales from those anyways.
Yeah.
And usually, like, people will buy your stuff from after that. We've seen some of that.
Yeah.
Which is cool.
Yeah, and it's like, yeah, it's like,
people
you wouldn't
never
have
heard
known about that album unless you downloaded it, so it's just like, I'm just
yeah.
happy you know it.
Yeah, it's, I think it's pretty cool.
Yeah. But I really, like, one of the greatest things about being in a band is when you get that message in your email when someone buys a thing off Bandcamp. It, like, makes me cry, like, happy tears. And it's even better when they have, like, a Bandcamp profile, and then under your album it has a little box. I don't know. It's just a really good feeling. It's nice. So.
Yeah.
But downloading's cool. It's fine.
Well, look at it this way. All those people who download your albums, when you guys go on your world tours and sell vinyl, I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah, true.
Yeah.
I wonder, like, I wish I could see, like, a stat. Like, just, I'm curious.
Like, who's downloading?
Yeah, out of, like, how many. So that would have been cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you download illegally, just, you know, tell
just
us.
Just mess it.
Yeah.
Hey, download your album illegally. Oh, thanks.
Like, all right, thanks. Yeah. I'll send a personal thank you.
I bought the CD.
That's because you're the best.
Number one.
At a show. All right, now, my next question is for Joe.
Yeah.
Faux hawk.
Yeah, in high school, I rocked the faux hawk. I actually regret it. My girlfriend...
You regret it?
Yeah, she's like, you know, like, it doesn't look that good. And at the time, I didn't, like,
That's
I didn't funny. See this, but looking back on old pictures, I'm like, you know what? I could have had better hair. Like, with, like, the length I had... It wasn't the best style, and there was a lot of different options I could have chose. But, you know, at the time, a lot of people were rocking full locks at the time. Like, it made sense, and it didn't look as weird. But looking back, I'm like,
yeah,
definitely could have been doing better things. And I just remember we changed, there's one of our first Facebook pictures ever. We changed the Wikipedia list of celebrity faux hawk wearers, and we put me on there, and we just screenshotted it, and then we just... It lasted, I think, for at least a day before they fixed it. I don't know.
It was like longer than fast.
Okay. I thought it was a bit longer than usual.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I had that hairstyle from grade 11 to 12, and then university, I think I just kind of... I don't know what happened. Now I'm growing my hair long. I haven't grown my hair long like this before. I don't think I'll ever go back to the faux hawk again. But it was nice while it lasted. Well, Jeff's never had a faux hawk. I was going to say, at least everyone has a faux hawk phase, but it's not true. It's not true at all.
Definitely not true.
Zach rocks like a little flat thing right now.
Well, when you both had faux hawks, you guys...
No, we never had it at the same time. Zach had long hair when I had the faux hawk.
True.
And now I have long hair, and Zach has short hair. We gotta keep alternating.
Yeah. Otherwise, we'll be the same person.
Us for the same.
As they say.
Yeah, on paper.
Well, I must say you have awesome hair. You have awesome hair now.
Thank you.
Now, grind. People can grind to your music. You found that people could grind to your music on January 24th, 2010.
Oh my god.
Explain how people grind to your music.
I don't know, but we were playing a friend's house party. Do you remember this? Because back in high school, I don't know, more people had parties and stuff. We didn't really go to a lot of parties, but we were playing a friend's house party, which is so weird. We're not a house party band. We are not a party band.
Yeah.
And
just imagine like post-rock or whatever.
Yeah, it's not the music you listen to drunk.
It's really weird.
We're not fun. I don't know. We're like a really listening band. Like, yeah, I feel like you don't really move to us. Like, I don't really care if people are like sitting down in our shows, as long as they're listening. Like, I don't care if they're not at the front. Like, as long as they're listening, like, that doesn't matter. Like, if they're listening, because that's what you do with our band. I mean, we have good energy, I think, though.
Yeah.
And it is cool when people vibe out. But yeah, like, people were really drunk, and I don't know, we were playing NCIX, and like, I think at least two different sets of people were doing their thing. And I was just like, I don't know how, but it happened. I think they're really drunk.
You can do anything when you're that drunk.
Yeah. I mean, NCX has like a pretty good groove. I don't know. I don't really know how it works. I don't understand it.
That's the way they're... Yeah. They're not going to change.
You know what I realized is weird? Like... No, I don't want to get into that. That's fine. But yeah, it's just strange. But yeah, we're not a fun band. We're fun.
That was the show where, like, the police came and stuff, right?
I think one of her friends, she, like, fell down and, like, knocked herself out and she had to go to the hospital or something.
Okay.
I think that was that one.
Fun times.
Yeah. The fact that we play parties is really strange. Okay.
Grinding to post-rock.
But it wasn't, like, our post-rocky phase, but it still wasn't grindable music.
Well, at least they weren't dancing the Macarena.
It's true. That would have been weird.
You guys got a bus for rides to shows on January 11th, 2010.
No, I don't think we ended up going through with any buses. There was something that...
I think we thought
the
about
Supernova
it,
culture would kind of push on you. They're like, oh, your show's in Toronto. You're 15, so your parents don't want to drive you. But why don't you rent a bus... And have your like friends pay to get you to shows. And looking back, I'm like, man. But a couple of our friends' bands did that. I mean, it was fun, actually, going on a bus with like all your friends.
Like a party bus down to...
Well, no, it was just a school bus. But it was a party.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's the idea, right?
But yeah, we've done that with... like, we've been to two shows for a friends' band like that. And actually, you know what? It was a lot of fun. But we thought about doing it for our shows, but we just never... We're like, it's too much like planning. We don't want to deal with that. But yeah, that was the thing that younger bands did to get people out from Toronto, like, to Toronto, because it was just hard. And, you know, it's not a bad idea, but, like, just...
When you're like, young, can't really drive, it's not bad.
Yeah.
Not a bad idea.
It was fun, but we never ended up going through with it for our shows.
Hmm. Wow.
That's an old post. You did some digging.
A lot of sleepless nights.
Jeez. I'm sorry.
Joe, Belly Guitar Scrape, August 15th, 2011.
Oh, okay, so we're recording Burn Out the Sky. Oh. And we recorded the song a couple times. We recorded twice with Zach's dad, I think. Or no. Was it twice? I recorded three times
in total. Yeah, I think it was more.
We told twice with Zach's dad and once somewhere else. And on the one of the takes we did with Zach's dad, we got some cool fret noise sounds in between these like spots, like just by moving my hands. Mm-hmm. And we were trying to recreate them in the studio, but mm-hmm. it was hard. So we just tried different things, you know, just like scraping the guitar against different parts of the body, and we kind of used whatever worked. I think that sound is in there, so it did work out. But yeah, it was just to imitate this fret noise sound. That was the coolest thing when we first started recording, just noticing like those little things like that happened by accident that were actually amazing, like hand fret noise or mainly just hand fret noise, but like could be really cool. I really like fret noise.
Funnest part of recording is just like doing random stuff.
Yeah, trying different things,
crazy like things, getting feedback. And
like, yeah, feedback's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you have to do some moves for feedback too.
crazy dances and stuff.
Yeah. So I don't know, that's a lot of fun. And every time you listen to the recording, you just kind of point out those little things. Like, oh, yeah, that's when I grinded that guitar against my stomach.
That's the cool thing. It's like every little sound is deliberate, you know?
Yeah.
On a recording.
So it was deliberate. It wasn't just me being silly. Hmm.
Very cool. Yeah, I must say, seeing that guitar scrape was very inspirational for me, actually.
Good.
I tried that for hours.
See what sounds you can get.
Yeah, I think some skin came off of my guitar.
Oh, jeez. I'm sure not. But yeah, next step.
He's going hard.
That's what get you different tones and stuff, so that's smart.
Now, Joe, my next question is for you. In a interview with Substruct on August 13th, 2012...
That was fun.
You said that you wanted to marry Kenny Bridges.
Oh.
Explain.
I don't know. I every time Kenny gets brought up, we love Kenny. He's actually, like... Okay, so one, always love Monin, like, coolest band. And then... I don't normally care for the artists in the band, like, that much. Like, I'm like, you know, like... They're just a person. Like, I'm just a person. It's not like we're going to be friends. But Kenny's actually the coolest guy ever. Like, you met him, and it was, like, confirmed nicest man. And, you know, he's, like, a good friend of ours now. And I probably wouldn't... Like, he has a wife and stuff. I mean, I you know, it's one of those things when you really like someone, you say you want to marry them.
It's just not the right time or place.
Yeah. He's just a great... I'm pretty sure every interview that happened, I just had to talk about how awesome he is. He's just a really cool guy.
There's
likes cool things. Likes, he's a lot of fun to be around.
Yeah,
it's really cool. Nice. Yeah. So we love him.
Yeah, he's a lot like us, which is cool.
Yeah,
he likes a lot of the same things.
So. Yeah, we have a lot of common interests, so it would work out, I think, long term. You know, but yeah, it's just a lot of fun working with him, and it's cool. It's hard because we meet a lot of cool producers and engineers, and it's like, oh, it'd be cool to record with them, but like. Kenny exists. And he lives really close. I don't know, everything just works out. He's a great guy. Mm. Hi, Kenny. You probably won't watch this, but...
2 hours? Close.
Yeah. He knows.
I heard a beep. Alright. Speaking of Kenny Bridges, Star Wars.
Yeah, Kenny loves Star Wars. He has a lot of cool Star Wars things in his house. His kids like Star Wars. Really excited for the Star Wars movie.
That comes out, what, December?
Yeah.
That's pretty exciting.
We would watch the trailer, like, one recording, and just get hype.
Yeah. We would watch, like, it would just be on.
He was re-watching Star Wars, like, while we're, like, I think he was just re-watching, the first one. Like, when we went there one day, like, before recording, he would just watch things. Because he doesn't have, he's super busy. He has Star Wars shirts. I don't know. He loves it. He likes cool things, so... Yeah.
I like Star Wars. I'm, like, crazy about it.
Yeah, we're not, like, as crazy as him, but we're like, yo, that's cool.
Yeah.
I don't know. He loves it, though.
Very cool. iTunes.
Okay. I mean, I have iTunes. I couldn't reinstall the new iTunes for a while. I don't know if that's what this is about. But I just installed an older version. Anyways, if you're talking about our music on iTunes, okay, yeah, so
that's what I'm thinking about.
Yeah.
It was for one of the
we played this landmark battle events, of the bands,
and we won third place.
Fifth place. Yeah.
And they gave us like distribution on iTunes or something
through this company called Noisy Planet. Don't ever use them for distribution. Like
they put our EP on iTunes, and I'm pretty sure we haven't seen a single cent of like any money we made.
And I know people have bought it on iTunes because people came up to me and they're like, "Oh, I bought your album on iTunes," and I'm like, it's on Bandcamp.
And like we've emailed them so many times.
Yeah,
like,
Jeff ignores us completely. Yeah, the guy like.
I've been on like maybe like 20 times over the last like I don't know how long it's been, like 6 years.
Yeah, so we're kind of like going into this new one or like don't really want an iTunes. Although a couple days ago I actually just put it up on iTunes.
The distributor.
But I used a different distributor.
That's like for our own thing. Yeah.
Yeah. So like we got free distribution because normally you have to pay like a certain amount to put stuff up and. So obviously, because it was free, it ended up being the worst, I guess.
Yeah.
This time, I went with like a different distributor, which was more like reputable from different sources, and it wasn't too expensive either. Like, it was one of the better rates that I found, and they put it up on all the things too. Noisy Planet did that as well. Like, our first album was also on Spotify. Didn't even know. Like, they distributed it everywhere. They just didn't. Properly distribute the royalties. Any royalties.
Yeah. Like, whereas they just like. Then we just stole our music.
We have an account and we can check. I mean, I literally just put it up. Like, we haven't even announced that it's up. I'll probably announce that it's up by the time this gets out, hopefully. So if you do use iTunes and Spotify and those things, like, check it out. But Bandcamp's the truth. Like, gotta love Bandcamp. It's so good.
Bandcamp's pretty awesome.
It's also cheaper on our Bandcamp.
It's very easy. It looks nice.
Yeah, you could also choose to give us more money if you want, which is a really cool feature you should take advantage of. but on iTunes, I think it's $9.90, because it's like $1 or the album. I don't know. They just set their prices. But on Bandcamp, I put it at.
I think the royalties are different too. Like iTunes takes a bigger cut, right?
Yeah, Bandcamp takes a smaller cut, and then I don't know. Everyone's trying to take a cut.
Yeah, it's tough.
It's fair.
It's really tough.
Being a musician's hard.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you must suffer for your art.
Yeah. Unfortunately.
Yeah. I work.
You make like nothing.
Yeah, we pretty much all our day job.
You make like nothing, and then like people try to take a bit of your nothing.
Yeah, that's the worst part.
And it's like this is awful.
Yeah,
I'm making like $10. Why are you trying to take like $5 from me? Like, come on, man. It's,
not nice. Like we use pretty much like any money we make from a show or merch sale. Like it's not going to us. It's going to making more music, which is you know like. And then our day jobs are also going to making more music. So, you know, like, just think about that. Like, when you listen to the song, just think about that for a second, you know? But I know, we like it. Like, we wouldn't do it if we didn't like it. But just want you to know that that's where it's going if you're buying your album. It's, like, really helping you more than us because you can hear more songs. Every time someone asks you, like, yeah, when are you recording a new album? It's like, when I get another $5,000.
We haven't, paid off our old album.
It's like, did you plan on donating?
Because
if so, I'll gladly.
It's forever in debt.
Like, yeah, so just gotta understand, like, it's hard, like, being in the band at the state we're in, we can't just pump out music all the time. Like, we gotta, like, save up.
Well, this strain of a conversation leads into my next question. Mac and cheese. Or ramen noodles.
We really like mac and cheese. I recently learned how to make it.
There's a nice documentary of it online on our YouTube.
Yeah. I thought I was getting good at it, and then I wasn't improving, because I was making it at least once a week. Zach is really, like, Zach, Jeff, really good at making it. Mel's good, too.
It's not hard to make.
No, just, like, I don't know, it's consistent. I kind of mess up things sometimes.
Kind of mess up things?
I'm good, like,
yeah, I just realize, watch your YouTube video.
Yeah.
It's one of our studio things.
I made extra creamy, and I'm like, oh, this always comes out, like, cheesy. And then when I made original, it was so bad. And I'm like, wow, like, I did not manage this cheese packet, like, well enough. Like, with the milk. Like, I just ruined it. So, I have to figure out original still. I'm pretty good at Extra Creamy, but it's a different game. Maybe for me, I guess yes. Not for anyone else.
Some major thoughts on Mac.
Yeah, it's good though.
Hey, mac and cheese is hard. Cooking is hard.
It is.
Speaking of your vlogs, my next question is your vlogs.
Yeah, Zach hasn't finished the rest of them. If you're watching this, you know, we still want you to do it. There's still stuff. But it's good that he was editing and, like, shooting for us. Like, Zach has this good camera and...
Yeah.
He has some pretty good skills.
We have a lot of, like, we have a lot of footage that we can cut together and stuff.
Yeah, so...
It's just good to have that sort of stuff on your show.
Yeah, it was fun. Like, Zach did a good job editing them and taking nice pictures, and we got some fun stuff. It kind of was unfortunate. Like, Mel was super busy during our recording process, so she's, I don't know, she was, like, doing school and work at the same time, so she wasn't always there. She was kind of there for the rest of the stuff that wasn't really out yet.
Yeah.
But, it's just fun to see, I guess, everyone just kind of doing things.
Yeah.
I don't know. Did anyone watch those?
I did.
No. Okay, that's good. No, I think they have a good amount. I realize, like,
I think a decent
with those kinds of videos, like, 300 views, that's really good.
That's
actually great.
Yeah.
But when you think of, like, video, like it's, like, really... 300 views.
Yeah.
But, like, for watching, like, me make mac and cheese,
people don't,
like,
re-watch those, really.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's, like, it's one
cool.
guy just watching them 300 times.
Yeah. I'm happy that people watch them.
Making mac and cheese.
I'm happy that we have them to, like, look back on the experience, because it was a fun time.
Yeah, that's cool.
Also caught Kenny doing some stuff. We have some footage of Kenny that he probably doesn't want on the internet, so...
Yeah.
I'm sure lots of people do, actually, thinking back.
Yeah.
Kind of guy he is. He's a fun
those
guy.
Those are for
no, I'm kidding.
Our private tapes.
Yeah.
Hey, Hey, I mean, the internet's forever.
So
until,
true.
Of course, the servers break down.
True.
All right, now, my next question is this. You guys, the first time you guys played the Masonic Lodge was last year, I believe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What was that like?
I was really excited to play the Lodge because we used to go to a lot of shows there. We saw, well, before we went, I saw... I saw, like, Elosarma, Bulletproof Tiger...
Oh, like, way back.
Sparrows, Red Threat. We would go to a lot of shows there, and I really want to play. I really like the scene over there. I really like Streetsville.
Yeah, it's cool because there's a good young crowd.
Yeah, all ages. I really like all ages shows.
Yeah.
That's
sort of what we're missing here in Brampton.
Yeah.
There's, like, not really a young scene that's, like, consistent. So to play there is really cool.
Yeah, I really like the venue's history. I like the way it looks. It looks, like, cozy. Yeah. I like the Music Saga Mrs. scene. That's what I was going to say. Mississauga music scene. So I was pretty stoked to play.
Yeah.
I mean...
it was a pretty good show, too.
It was pretty good. We were on last, but there's still, like, a decent crowd and an involved crowd. And then we got to play another show there a couple months later. That was really good, too. So.
Yeah.
I'm hoping to play there again soon. I actually have a really cool idea for the Lodge. Gonna happen. Don't know when, but surprise.
Secrets.
I will wait with bated breath.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'll tell you after.
I believe you and I have share some friends. Cloud Everest.
Yeah.
Aren't they done now?
They
changed their name to
band
Silas,
names
and then
Chris
now
left
they're
the band.
Oh.
Chris left the band.
Okay,
they're
so
done.
They're just
so actually, like, Chris was in a class of mine at York, and I didn't know he played in a post-rock band or was interested in post-rock music, and which would have been nice because I didn't like anyone in that class and I didn't talk to anyone, so maybe I should have talked to someone more.
Nice.
So we started talking more after, and he really wanted to play with their band, which is cool.
He's your grade?
No, he's like he's a lot younger.
Oh, okay.
It was like an open, like, course
right.
We both took.
Oh, I see.
But yeah, like, I don't know. It's cool seeing other, like, post-rock bands on the scene, because there's, like, none, like, in Ontario that I know of, aside from them, like, barely any. And we're not even, like, a full-out post-rock band. Like, we, like, half commit, not even, like, 25%. There's, like, two other post-rock bands, so, like, that was really cool, and then we became friends with the rest of the guys, and they're all really nice.
Yeah, they're really awesome.
we don't really see them. I don't know. Like, we don't see them that much. It'd be nice to play with them more. Are, like,
at the lodge a couple times.
Yeah, or, like...
And they never really...
They don't play often enough yet. They're still new. I want to... Like, they're a good band, though. So, I hope they work something out. It's sad Chris is not in the band anymore. That means they'll never get to play with us again. And he's asked me. So, now I feel bad. But I'm sure we'll play with Sean and John again. And hopefully they find some people to play with if they need to. Or they could just duo it.
Yeah.
I don't know.
They're cool.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hopefully it works out.
Good luck for them.
Well, my xylophone abilities are top notch, so there's that.
That'd be cool. That would work. Audition. You should do it.
Those have been with a dedicated xylophone player.
We were considering putting xylophone in a couple of songs.
A couple songs, yeah.
Yeah. Mel plays. Yeah. Not that you, like, for the stuff we were doing, you wouldn't need to be, like,
yeah, you wouldn't need good
but, like,
all.
We have one.
Yeah. So. Cool. I did not know that.
Yeah.
Alright, now. Oh, yes, that reminds me. Have you guys really never seen the ocean?
I've definitely seen the ocean. Have you seen the ocean?
I think so. I didn't write that lyric, so. I'm pretty sure it's some kind of metaphor that I don't understand. That's what Jeff does. That's how lyrics work, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've seen the ocean.
Okay.
Haven't you been to California?
Yeah. I don't know if I've been on that side.
Oh, okay. You haven't, like,
been where, to the beach? Which ocean have you seen?
Me? Well, I've flown to, like, Malaysia, so.
Which one is that?
I've been on both sides. I've seen.
So you've seen the Pacific Ocean?
I guess. I've seen
both. Doesn't even know which ocean you've seen.
I don't know, man. I've seen water before.
Yeah, but do you know it's an ocean? There's only, like, seven oceans.
Yeah, dude.
Is there seven? Six? You five?
Pacific Ocean.
To the other side of the world.
Ocean, Indian Ocean.
Because, okay, usually you go through Europe.
Antarctica.
And then on your way back.
I used to know this.
You go through the other way.
Okay, well, so you don't, like, even remember it, so you might as well have not seen it.
I'm not great at geography.
Okay. I used to know. Whatever. I think there's five.
Well, Pacific is to our left, right?
Yeah.
And then to our right is...
Atlantic, and then doesn't matter either way. And there's an Indian Ocean. I think there's an Antarctic, like some kind of Arctic one.
I think.
Oh,
so,
the
yeah.
Arctic. I don't know.
I think it's the Arctic.
Doesn't matter. I don't know. It's a metaphor. I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
Well,
remember? Never mind. I think there's an article. Yearning for unseen sights.
Yeah, yeah. One of, like, the reviews for a song.
Yeah.
Was it, like?
No, it was a premiere.
Yeah,
it's just like, yeah, the lyrics
like
are about
post-rock emo kids.
Yeah,
yearning for unseen sights.
Yeah,
it's like, wow, this is, like, really, like, crazy. It's really thick.
I've never seen the ocean. I'll be honest. The closest I've seen
ever.
The closest I've seen to the ocean is the Caribbean Sea.
Okay.
And
that's a sea. That's different.
It is different.
Besides that, not never an ocean. I see lakes, I see seas.
Yeah, I've definitely seen lakes, for sure.
Rivers.
Sorry, Caribbean Sea sounds hype. We'll use sea in our next lyric. Never seen sea. No sea. Jeff will figure it out.
Caribbean Sea. New song.
Okay.
So what are the lyrics about?
I've never seen the ocean.
Mm-hmm.
Mel gave me an interpretation and I cried.
Yeah, like...
Really?
I'm not joking.
When I write lyrics, like, it's very much stream of consciousness. And then I sort of, like, write them, put them on the page, and then, like, not think about it ever again. So if I told you what it's about, I'd have to sit down and kind of think about it. But it's very much about regret and wishing that you did something different. That's sort of the main idea. Yeah.
And you can kind of put it to your own experiences, I guess.
Like, yeah, yeah. I don't really like saying, like, this is exactly what it's about.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because I feel like everyone, like, connects with songs in different ways and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's the main idea about regret. Yeah.
Well, it does come off. It does come off thematically in the song.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very deep. Very deep. But and then lyrics in general. Lyrics in general. I guess it answers my question. I guess in general. Is there any other particular modes you usually go in with writing lyrics, particularly any type of Is there any particular, like, type of emotion you want to capture, or you just write whatever pops into your head? I'm curious.
So for the album, a lot of it was about where a lot of people our age are, which is, sort of, either entering school or exiting, like, post-grad and figuring out where you want to go. So I would say a lot of what I write about, at least, is just the general experience of, you know, what you're going through. I mean, like, when, like, Burn Out the Sky kind of stuff was, like, teenage stuff, right?
Well, no, Mel wrote a lot of that
stuff, too.
And it's, a lot of her songs are, like, concepts. Like, they're based off, like, ideas. So the lyrics were a lot different on that one.
Yeah.
Aside from NCIX's, which Jeff wrote, which I still think fits in lyrically with what we were writing for the new album.
Yeah.
It's kind of just about, like, I guess, like...
But, yeah, it's, like, you know, trying to find the place that you're trying to be. Like, trying to figure out the place where you belong.
Yeah, like, it's, like...
And, yeah, just, like, not really knowing where to go. And I feel like a lot of people our age don't really know what to do with the rest of their life. It's, like, really overwhelming almost.
Yeah.
It's, like, very
We
fast.
Definitely don't. So, yeah. That's why we wrote about it.
Yeah. And it's sort of weird because, like, they tell you, like, you know, you have to decide this, like, end of high school or whatever. But, like, to make a decision then and then, like, go to it now, it's, like... You definitely weren't equipped to make the decision back then.
Yeah.
And you still aren't equipped to do that now. Like,
yeah.
So it's like, there's so many different things to do. And like,
yeah.
I don't know, it's hard.
And then, I don't know, like, lyrically, yes, Jeff took on a lot of the lyrics for the album. I mean, sometimes I'm terrible with lyrics, so bad. Like, that's why I need a band. no, but I'll come up with like two words or like
a
line.
Yeah, we've all come
like,
up a little bit.
Jeff, like, I have this line, go, and then he'll just be like, song. And then Zach's come up with a couple lines, and Mel's come up with a couple lines. But Jeff and Mel are, like, the kind of, like, the writers.
Yeah,
I just kind of like, yo, why don't you try this? Mm. But yeah, it worked out. I don't know, it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Cool.
And then sometimes we're like, forget lyrics. That's too hard.
Yeah. It's because, like, usually, actually, we'll write lyrics at the very end.
Yeah, they're, like, last minute.
Even melodies, like, we'll write vocal melodies at the very end.
And then sometimes we're like, you know what? Maybe you shouldn't have lyrics.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I feel like we made the right call on, like, the songs without lyrics. Like, I'm, like, thinking, because
yeah,
we
think
did
so.
Think about, like, maybe we should put some vocals on top of, like, Solaris or this and see how it goes. And, no, I feel like they're good.
Yeah,
sometimes I'll rap over them when I listen to them in my car.
Yeah.
And that's
but
it.
Very much like.
So I'm glad I left them instrumental for that.
Lyrics and like melodies like are very much like spontaneous. I feel for us.
Yeah.
It's like if it doesn't happen, it doesn't happen. But maybe during a practice, we'll be like, "Yo, what about this melody?" And be like, "Okay, that's what the song is."
Yeah, and it really like develops the song.
Yeah. Rather than like we like sit down and like grind out different melodies and like. This should be here. Like, I feel like we don't really do that as much, but we do that sometimes. But,
yeah.
Vocals for us are, like, at the end, and we want them to feel very natural, so I don't know. It kind of comes out that way.
Yeah. Very cool. Yeah, whenever I would write lyrics, I'd have like two pages of for one song, and I'm like, how do I fit this song to
a two-minute
song?
No, yeah, when I write lyrics, I just like
we
scribble
do a lot of melodies first,
like words on pages, and it'd be so messy.
Yeah,
and
Jeff's
like,
lyric sheets are funny.
And I'm like 10 pages, be like, okay, what? How do I make this into the song?
Yeah,
like,
it won't even be like blank paper.
Sense,
it's just like
blank
paper, and instead of writing like straight, he'll just write diagonal for some reason.
Yeah. It gets pretty crazy.
And his writing's, like, really messy.
Yeah.
I remember when Jeff and Mel used to write lyrics together, they would fight over words.
Yeah, we would
like,
be very specific and very...
Yeah, just, like, the meaning of, like, a tense of a word. They'll, like, no, this implies this,
yeah.
but this implies this.
I
and
think...
then they'll ask, like, me and Zach, and I'll be like...
They're like, they don't care.
I don't care. Just put
yeah.
the lyric in the song so
I think
you can play
me and Mel
it.
Being from, like, English backgrounds, like, we both... Mel's an English specialist, and I minored in English in university. Yeah, we were both, like, very much like that, looking into, like, double meanings of words or, like...
Yeah.
Just very simple, like, subtle things that can change the meaning and stuff like that. So, I don't know.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah.
Hmm. Very cool. Very cool indeed.
Yeah, it's weird because we don't sing sometimes, so you think, like, we don't really... Like, I feel like our lyrics are, like, really important, but, like, sometimes we're just like, oh, no lyrics. Yeah. So I feel like it gets, like... I don't know, I feel like we're known for instrumentals for a while, but the lyrics are, like, well, like, we think about those, too.
Yeah.
I really enjoy well-written lyrics, so...
Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
I don't care.
It changes the dynamic of a song a lot.
I don't know lyrics to any songs.
That's fair, yeah. I think, like, one of the most important things, though, is, like, having, like, you know, like, a nice, like, chorus idea.
Yeah.
That sort of sums up the idea.
Yeah, that's
and
true.
And everything else, like, can be totally whatever.
That's true.
But as long as you have, like, one line to connect to, like that. You know? Yeah. Like, one line that you can just connect to, and then, like...
That's true. You're right.
And that's sort of... As long as you have that, then it's
good. It makes a song.
Yeah, it makes
a
song.
Yeah, because I don't know all the words to songs, but I'll know, like, a general line.
Yeah. I think that's really important.
Boil Soft Unregistered Version, September 10th, 2008.
Yes.
Oh, okay. That's fun.
Those are one of the real...
Yeah,
the first videos
ever. when we started the band, we would write songs and we would do like digital camera videos of them. Mm-hmm. And we used to jam in Zach's basement and he had the electric kit, so the sound came out like okay, like
yeah.
You could hear everything
cool.
Pretty clearly. And I guess like the file was like too big or something.
Yeah, so we had
compress
to like
it.
Compress it so you can like upload it to Facebook
or
whatever.
Or like yeah, or YouTube, and that's just what came on the front.
And which songs did we do?
We did Blank Canvas or Monkeys. We used to call it Monkeys. That was a codename.
And then we did Sad Song.
And then we did The Sad Song. I don't think that had the Boiled Soft thing.
I don't
those
remember.
Were like the two YouTube
and,
singles.
Yeah. Those, Monkeys was our first song ever written?
No, it was our
third
song ever written, but it was like our first song written collectively as a band.
Yes.
Like, I used to, the first two songs, I kind of would just tab out on Guitar Pro and be like, Here you go, play this, and then Zach do whatever. And then the third song, I came in with the idea, and we kind of, it was me, Mel, and Zach, and we wrote it together, and we're like, whoa, so good. And then Jeff showed up late to practice, and he played on top, and we're like, whoa, like, we lost our minds. We're like, wow, this is amazing.
Yeah, it came together, it was
yeah,
cool.
And then that kind of, like, that was just like, okay, I don't need to do anything. We just started jamming all our songs together, and...
Yeah, so that's, like, a really old video on our Facebook that, go deep, you can watch.
Yeah, it's on our old YouTube channel that our friend made for us that we don't know the password for.
Yeah, that
like
song, it's like a 5 minute song or something.
Yeah, solo.
And it's got like a 2 minute solo.
Yeah.
That's definitely like our classic rock era. Like,
yeah,
like,
I was
really
like, yeah, Jeff, I want you to solo this whole entire time.
And it was cool.
It's
like
a pretty solid song.
Yeah.
There's lyrics to that song, but not in that video.
Yeah.
I think there's a live version.
That song,
if you dig.
Sort of turned into a lot of different songs. Like, that song...
Oh, I guess, like, the found... Like,
kind
the
of that feel, and,
yeah.
Like, that turned into, like, Solaris, and Honest Fear 2.
Lots of our new songs
like,
are inspired
things,
by that,
Things
yeah.
You Can't Forget. So, like, those... All those songs are sort of derivative from that one video, so that's pretty cool.
Nice.
We actually were, like, jokingly playing it, like, the last practice we had.
Yeah.
Just
yeah,
like,
we were actually talking about this
yeah.
pretty recently.
Weird.
Yeah.
Weird.
Hmm. Joe, you like to put stickers on turtles. December 30th, 2009.
No, that was a song quote. That's Dimitri Martin.
Oh.
Yeah, I think, I don't know if I quoted. I don't know. Dimitri Martin's fun.
I don't know anything about
He has, like, those, like funny one lines. That's a good one.
Stickers on turtles.
I just stole that bit for Twitter. I thought I put quotations. It's okay.
No.
Moving on.
There were
I'm
none.
Sorry. Sorry for misleading you. I'm a fraud.
We should just, like, tweet, like, really weird and random things.
Yeah,
like,
just because we know
when,
you're looking
yeah,
at
Yeah, when we do interview number two, like, 5 years down the line.
Yeah.
Just, like, throw
They're, like, planted for you.
Yeah. Just, like, really awkward plans.
Yeah.
Now, a set of lyrics. Lyrics. September 15th, 2008, In Your Pants lyrics.
Oh, I thought I took that down. You know what's funny? That's a codename for a song, and it's funny because River Groves have a song called In Your Pants,
yeah.
too.
Yeah, they do. This is a really early song, too.
Yeah, this was, I think, our fourth song. And it was one of her most upbeat songs. I think I wrote a lot of the lyrics, or that's why they're kind of bad. And then Jeff helped a bit.
What's the chorus again?
I don't want to say. It's too late. And then we called it In Your Pants for like no reason, but I kind of think about the lyrics and it kind of can make sense to that in a weird way.
To In Your Pants?
No. I don't know. Maybe about regretting or like just missing out.
Okay. Missing out in your pants.
Yeah, but it was just this really upbeat song. And
it makes sense.
I don't know. We never played it ever again. I don't know. We actually had a video for it too, like a YouTube live recording, and we didn't release it. And I think we only played it at like a couple shows. It was fun.
It's a fun song.
It was fun.
Yeah.
It was really short.
Very long.
That progression for that song, I really liked the progression. I think I used it in a lot of different
ways. It was very much like a chuggy, like,
pop. Yeah, there was like a riff.
It's like, and then I was like, harmonizing it. I was like,
yeah. It had a cool bridge section, though, that would be like, would still kind of fit in with what we do. But I don't know. Anyways, just random, like, we talked about code names before. That was that song's code name.
Hmm.
Yeah. And we didn't rename it ever.
Yeah.
Fascinating.
Yeah.
Fascinating. Hmm.
Is that still there? Isn't that gone?
Nope.
Somewhere on Facebook?
I thought I took it down.
I thought we took it down too.
Maybe. I'll check again.
Yeah, we definitely should take those down.
It's still there.
Why? Right. That'll be really out of place here.
Yeah.
It's just like, what the?
Extra Life for Kids.
Yeah, we do that.
That's coming up soon, isn't
November,
it?
November, I think. It's usually like October, isn't
October,
it?
November. It's
this
like
year is November. So it's a 24-hour gaming marathon, and you raise money for kids.
It's
for
just Toronto. An excuse to play games for 24 hours.
Exactly.
But we actually, like,
we actually raise money, like, though, for the kids.
Yeah.
Usually, we just chill at my house, and like, my basement.
Set up as many TVs
as possible.
If
you come, you bring, like, $5, $10, whatever.
Yeah, you bring... Donate. You bring games, and then you...
Everyone has, like, TVs and stuff, and we just, like, play different games.
Yeah,
it's
we set
awesome.
Goals. Try to beat this game this night. I tried...
Last year, what did you play?
I tried
you
beating the
Super
original
Mario, right?
Super Mario front to back, no skipping.
Front to back, yeah.
Yeah.
Crazy.
And I couldn't do it in that night.
Yeah.
I spent the rest of the week trying to beat it.
Yeah.
And then I finally beat it, like, maybe 3 days later. Like, I would try, like, a bit every
night.
Oh,
yeah.
And then, after I beat it again right after. Like, I just caught in a loop. It's like, do you want to try? It's slightly harder. They change all the Koopas to, like, the black shell ones.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know if you've ever beat it and then played it again. And some of the platforms shrink. And I literally was just, like, I was
good.
Playing so much Mario that, like, I didn't know other things in life.
Yeah.
You know, like, when you just kind of get used to doing something.
Yeah.
So I'm like, oh, I'm just going to...
24 hours.
Yeah, I'm like, I'm just going to play this. And I literally beat it, the game again, like, on the harder mode, like, right after beating it the first time.
Yeah.
So I felt great.
Yeah.
Wow.
But I couldn't beat it the day of, like, for, like, 8 hours of trying.
Yeah. But, we try to do that every year just because it's an excuse to get together and play games. Which
we already do anyways.
Yeah, so it's cool. Last year, I think one of our friends beat Banjo-Kazooie front to back, which is pretty cool. We've done
Zach
Donkey Kong
front
to back.
Some like old.
I think Zach did
Zelda
1
Zelda
front to back. So that was pretty crazy.
But you played Earthbound last year?
Played Mother 3 last year, front to back. Which is pretty crazy. Yeah. It's fun. Fun times.
The only game I played in one sitting, I beat in one sitting, was Pokemon Blue. I beat it in four
one
hours.
One sitting?
I beat it in four
Pokemon
hours.
Pokemon Blue?
Yeah.
4 hours.
What
That's
the
kind
hell?
Of impressive.
That's like a life journey, Pokemon Blue.
Yeah, it took me 4 hours.
When did you play it? How old were you?
Know it inside out.
Did you start it, like, did you play it as a child?
Yeah, I grew up playing Pokemon games. That was the first Pokemon game I got when I was 6.
Did you beat it in 4 hours the first time you played it?
No.
Oh, like you went back.
I had played it before and a while. Like, the first time I played it took me, like, months to be able to get past the far-fetched.
Yeah, like, I was thinking back to those games when you're younger, because there's no internet to tell you how to beat
things.
Exactly. It's like, oh my god, I was a genius.
Yeah.
Like, how'd I figure this out?
It's cool, though. It's
yeah,
like,
it's awesome.
Trying to figure things out yourself, and, like,
yeah.
You talk to your friends, and you're like, oh,
okay,
did you know
when you
this?
Played it again, you beat it in 4 hours.
Yeah, I was, like, I was, I think, around 8, 9 at the time. And
oh,
so
really?
I was on a plane ride, and I'm like,
that's
I'm just going to, I reset it in just 4 hours.
That's crazy. That
that
game
crazy.
Was, like, a life, you know? It's, like, part of your life
yeah.
the first time you play it. It's an experience. Yeah.
Especially when trying to catch that Dratini.
Yeah.
Sit for hours. Finally get catch it. It runs away from me. Stupid Abra. Teleports away. Yeah, I shed tears over that game.
Yeah.
You finally catch almost everything and then your game corrupts.
Oh my god, yeah.
That's definitely
mine worse. Wouldn't save anymore when I tried to play it again.
Oh,
so.
Yeah.
I went through it twice. The first starter I had was Bulbasaur, the second one was Squirtle. I was dumb though, my starting six was stupid. Like, I had like a level 100 Sandshrew, like, didn't want to evolve it.
Sandshrew.
Because you know, like, the mass, like, the cheat where you get the rare candies?
Yeah, yeah.
So all my Pokemon were like level 100, oh, and I didn't evolve my Sandshrew. Yeah.
How did you get a level? Why you level 100 Sandshrew?
I like Sandshrew.
Yeah, that's like definitely the
but
worst.
But he's actually like not a good Pokemon.
Worst Pokemon to be like level 100.
No, yeah. He's not.
But cut?
It's like Sandshrew. No one likes Sandshrew.
I like Sandshrew.
It's like a level 100 Pichu.
Like, at least Pichu's like an electric Pokemon with cool moves.
Yeah, exactly. Sandshrew's like a freaking.
He's just like a lame ground Pokemon.
He's like a mole or whatever. I don't know who he is.
I like Sandshrew.
Well, that's impressive, actually.
No, you just use the cheat. The thing.
Yeah, I just cheated.
Still, I mean.
Thank you, though.
100 Sandshrew, I mean, that's impressive. Okay. Hexbug Racing.
Oh, that was just... When we got our Instagram for the first time, we just Instagram, like, everything. And I was at McDonald's, and when I don't want a lot of food at McDonald's, I get a Happy Meal. Because it's cheaper, and it came with a toy, and it was a hex bug, and I never used it again. Yeah. If you want it, okay, getting a Happy Meal at McDonald's, though, like, such good value, it's like $4. You get a cup, which you could refill for drinks, so that's like unlimited drinks, so that's good value. You get like four, you can get chicken nuggets, okay, because you can get like McDoubles off the value menu, which is like the same, it's bigger than the Happy Meal burger, so don't do that. Get chicken nuggets, fries, like, you get a decent, not the best amount, but like, if you're not that hungry, it's like a good snack. And you get some kind of yogurt thing and a toy for like $4, so it's good value. Happy Meal and a box that has games on it. So I'm just saying, like, if you're not that hungry, or if you want to just get like burgers off the value menu but you also want chicken nuggets, don't buy like a pack of chicken nuggets, buy a Happy Meal. You know, it's a good strat, just keep that in mind.
Well, nice. Well, I now want to get a Happy Meal.
Yep.
All right. You guys broke a record for the most shows in one night, November 27th.
That was a record.
10. You guys said it was a personal record.
Oh, it was a personal record. I thought you meant like, oh, we actually broke the record. Yeah, I think we've done that twice though, where we played two shows in one night. One time, okay, I think that one was we played a friend's basement show. And then we were later scheduled to play this bar in Toronto. And we played that set. Like, that set was long. I don't know if you remember that. On Cue.
The one covers?
No. Oh, that set was really long. But no, this was a different one. And we played, like, all the atmospheres, like, front to back.
I do remember that one. Yeah. That was for, like, November.
November. Yeah, it was for November. Yeah. And then we did it again one time. We were supposed to play the small show for our friends, like, at this little rehearsal studio, and then right before, our friend was hosting a show in Brampton, and Zach was busy, so we had another friend just play drums for us on the spot, like, unrehearsed, and he just jammed out, and it went okay. Do you remember that? Played at Good Times, and Bunny from Rob Zombies played drums, and then we went to Adnan's thing. So we've done it twice, two shows in one night.
Yeah, pretty hectic.
Yeah.
Fun, though. Good, well, if the shows are good.
Yeah.
Very cool. Very cool. My next question is, is the Brampton scene.
Right.
Now, a while ago, you guys were featured on, if I'm going to correctly, that's the newspaper in Brampton.
Yeah.
Where you guys talked about, for example, reviving a bit, being trying to help revive the Brampton scene to what it was kind of in the early mid-2000s. Explain how the Brampton scene has evolved over the years you guys have been playing shows there and going to shows there, and what it is like now.
The Brampton scene has a lot of history. So before, like, even my time, I heard it was awesome. Like, you had, like, bands like Monin and The Junction and playing around, and I kind of started getting involved with it when I was in grade 8. Everyone in high school had bands. Like, so many people had bands, and they're actually, this was like the MySpace era, and like, they're actually like putting up recordings and trying to, and playing a lot, and it was really cool. I played in a band, we played just like covers and stuff, but we played a show with a couple more popular bands at the time, and it was three bands from my music school and two bands that were in the Brampton scene, and it was at with Friends, which is now Ellen's, and there are 250 people there, which is insane, like crazy. But we weren't like a real band, I guess you can say. A lot of the other shows, Mel would go to a lot of the other shows, like Friends was the spot, and like Monine has played Friends, and Junction has played Friends, Ill Scarlet's played Friends. There were shows at like a Baptist church, there were shows at this place called The Hype. It was just like a thing a lot of like high school kids, more in like our early high school stage, like would go to. And then it kind of changed when we started the band. It kind of like died in popularity. Like less people had bands. The types of bands were like kind of like post-hardcore or like kind of like, I'm trying to think. Think like that Silverstein type emo.
Yeah.
That was like a very popular sound at the time. And then we kind of entered the scene, and the show scene was a bit different because the church, they stopped doing shows. The Hype was only like hardcore bands, and then it kind of died. Then it became like those Supernova shows we were talking about earlier, which had a lot of people, and there were a lot of bands as well. Like, in our high school, there was a good amount of band, and every high school had, like, a lot of different bands. So that was, like, Brampton for a while. Like, Supernova was doing their thing. There were a lot of people at shows, but there were, like, those weird shows with, like, 15 bands, and, like, I don't even know where any of those bands are now. Like, aside from, like, a couple of our friends, like, not a lot of them had, like, staying, like, decided to keep at it. There's a place called The Place, like, that... Like, there's a lot of people coming out to these shows because they, you know, Supernova was making these bands sell all these tickets. Blake would put on all the cool Brampton shows. He had a lot of pop rock bands and hardcore bands, but he didn't really start booking us till later, which was fair because it was, like, once we got our recordings. I don't know, the scene's kind of weird. I feel like the all-ages shows died down for a while, like, once we got older, because it was easier to get, like, 19-plus shows and... I don't know, there weren't as many old all-ages bands, so a lot of the 19-plus shows, man, there's so many shows, like, I can't even, like, process, like, which ones, like, there's a lot of empty shows, like, a lot of Brampton shows where we play to no one, and then there's shows like our CD release where we play to, like, 150 people, I'm just trying to, like, backtrack everything, there's too much, I feel like it's not as strong as it once was. But, and especially, it's probably even a worse state now, now that Blake kind of revived it a bit when he started doing his shed shows again. Mm-hmm. Those were probably some of the best shows, because they had a solid turnout of people who were really invested in the bands. Like, even though they could only fit, like, 40 people, everyone would just, like, stay for all the bands. Where, like, a lot of Brampton shows, we would just kind of, a lot of people would just be in and out. There's still shows going on at All Stars, Spot One, Ellen's, and I know Jesse Alacron is doing a lot to kind of push new shows and stuff, and is picking up again. But I feel like the amount of bands is maybe smaller now, or it's more scattered. When we were younger, like, everyone had a band. Now, the most active ones I can think of besides us are Stockholm Siesta, The Red Boy, which are great bands. Frenemies, kind of, they were pretty active before, but... I think real life is, like, catching up with them. Orca is a Friends band from Brampton, but they barely play ever, and they should play more shows. They definitely play more shows. Even though they only play Brampton, they just need to play more shows in general. I don't know. I think it's just more scattered now. And there's less bands, or at least the bands aren't working together the way they used to. It's really hard to pinpoint. The Brampton scene is very hit and miss. Like, you can put on an awesome show, and you can put on a show that doesn't do well, and it happens a lot. So you really got to find the right date, you got to find the right lineup, and you really got to make the effort. Like, a couple good notable shows, like, yeah, the Sheds Upland shows were really good. The Red Boy did those Logan's Hope fundraisers, and they had good turnouts. Birthday shows usually go well. It's hard. I don't know. It's a weird spot for shows, too.
I feel like there's a big disconnect between, like, our age and, like, high school.
Yeah, like, well. I think...
Because also, like, those bands... I don't know. I don't even know if they're
see, that's the high thing. School bands. Back early in the Brampton scene, it was dominated by a lot of high school bands, and there were older bands that played with them, and it kind of brought everything together.
Yeah. Well, like, I'm not even connected to this. Yeah. Like, I don't even know what high school
bands I think there once are. We left high school, there weren't that many high school bands. I just think... I don't think it's a thing about Brampton. I think it's more about the music scene in general now.
Yeah.
The younger kids don't seem as interested in being in a band and making band music. It's more like electronic music that's popular, or like pop music, which is not really like live band performance. So, I mean, I see, because we teach guitar too, and I don't know, like none of my students have bands.
None of mine either.
And like, you know, back in high school, like... we were in bands and we were like guitar students, you know? So I just think it's a less common thing.
Yeah.
And if there are high school bands, they don't really know about the local scene. Like, they don't really know where to play.
Yeah, there's not a great way to connect with them, and there's not great venues.
Yeah, and yeah, there's not spots for them to play. Whereas when we were in high school, we were connected with older bands.
Yeah.
And there were places to play. So I think that plays a large role, especially because our audience too is more scattered, or I guess people our age, like, they live in their university towns or whatever, or moved out to Toronto. So in a suburban area with, like, not a young crowd, it's just a smaller scene, I guess. That's what I'm trying to say. I think that's it. It's weird. But there are great bands in Brampton. Like, that's not the problem. I think it's more venues and having more young bands.
Well, I agree with you on the young bands part.
Yeah.
I agree with you on the young bands part.
Make a band. But, like, make sure you're good. No, I'm just saying, like, if you're making a band, like, actually, like, you know, like, practice. Commit. Like, don't just do it because, like, oh, like, I don't know. I when people say, like, they play guitar or, like, make a band to pick up girls, I don't understand that logic. I'm pretty sure that doesn't work.
It doesn't.
That's not a thing. Just, like, do it because you like playing music and, like, it's a fun thing to do. And, like, don't just, like, do it for the show. Like, really, like, practice and try to learn things well. And, you know, because one thing that we always did as a band, we practiced a lot. Like, when we started the band, we practiced 3 or 4 times a week because it was fun and we wanted to be super tight. So we still try to practice at least 2 times a week. So just, you know, if you're a new band, just practice as much as you can.
Good advice to live by.
Yeah.
Advice to live by. Alright, let's see. Oh. Return to Ravnica.
Return to Ravnica? Or
Ravnica. It doesn't matter.
Oh, you guys used to call it
Ravnica. We used to call it Ravnica.
Yeah. That's just a side in Magic. It was a big deal because...
Me and Zach used to play that set way back, and then they returned to it.
Like, while me and Melbourne are Magic phase. Yeah. So they just got us all back into it. And, yeah, it was pretty hype. If you know about Magic, it's hype.
If you know about Magic, then you know what that means, and you're like, whoa! Yeah. But if you know nothing, then you're like, I don't get it.
Yeah. So no one understands.
Yeah. So that's the idea.
Tacos.
Tacos?
Yes.
I like tacos.
I don't eat strong feelings about tacos. I don't think Mel doesn't eat tacos. Maybe. I don't really eat Taco Bell. I think Zach probably eats Taco Bells. I don't think it's one of our foods.
I don't think we have strong feelings about it.
Yeah.
But I think we're down.
Yeah.
If
like, I'd eat a taco, I think. Yeah. And we have to have, like, nothing on it. But I'd eat it.
There you go.
You guys played your first Mississauga show on December 31st, 2011.
Is that River Grove, Common Sound?
Yeah. Yes. I think so.
Yeah.
That's a great show because, yeah, that was River Grove's before River Grove's.
Yeah, so it was Al Quinn's band. I don't know who else was Brian in it?
Yes.
Al Quinn and Brian.
Brian.
Okay.
Brian? Yeah.
Cool show. Yeah. So. That show Pretty Odd played too.
And Pretty Odd, yes.
Yeah, so that was really cool. Just like looking like back, odd, that yeah. like us and Pretty Odd are still
yeah,
like
cool.
doing our thing, and
we're both
seeing a lot the ways we like develop like, too is really awesome. Also,
That was when we first met Alquinn then.
Yeah, and Al and Brian have been great friends for us in the scene, and
yeah.
I mean, we didn't really like we saw. I don't know. We didn't really get to talk to them that much after the band, but they reached out to us again like a couple years ago, or I guess after that, and we've become really close. And
yeah,
they're the show band.
Was just cool because it like started a lot of relationships.
Yeah, and it was a lot of
with
fun
with some
for
really
us.
Cool guys in the Mississauga scene. So.
Yeah, I talk about it with Al a lot, and we really like the Mississauga scene and the sense of community that was like building here, and that was kind of the start of it for us at least.
Yeah.
Hmm. Cool.
Yeah. Cool.
You guys are supposed to play a show here recently, I believe, but it got postponed.
A friend's band from school. A guy I met at York, he had a band and he works at a bar called The Valley. I've never heard of this bar. And his band plays every now and then, and he wanted us to come play, and it got postponed for like personal family reasons. Something happened, and that other day, I don't know why the other day fell through, but it didn't work out for either band, which is fine. I don't know. It was just us and their band, yeah. So we'll play together.
I think it was
on
like the new Mississauga venue, right?
It was called The Valley. Have you heard of The Valley?
The only first time I heard about it was actually for the show you guys
were
playing.
Yeah. So I don't
like,
really
okay,
know.
We're gonna try it.
And
but yeah, it just didn't fall through, and it's not a really big deal to us because
it was just a weird fit for us. Yeah,
it was like us and one other band.
Yeah, like we like playing with like you know like a couple other bands.
Yeah.
And I just don't know. Yeah, I don't know. I still have to see if we play there again. So, it'll be fun.
Very cool. Now, I have to ask this question. What are your guys' plans for the future?
So, we released our album. Now, I think we want to take on some smaller projects. So, like, splits.
Oh, I mainly just want to play a lot. Like, play as much as possible. Play wherever we can.
Like, I think we're not really worried about, like, releasing stuff quite yet.
Music. In terms of new music,
It's more just playing a lot of shows.
Yeah, so we're trying to play as much as possible. I've been sending out emails, like, everywhere. Trying to get our music heard wherever, so just getting it played on... I don't know, we've been sending
to get some
it everywhere.
Longer tours and stuff like that.
Yeah, and then I want to try to do a music video. Music videos are nice.
Yeah, I think we were going to think about, like, music videos and, like...
Live videos, maybe.
EPs, maybe like, a 3 or 4 song EP.
Yeah, like, our next release...
Maybe a split.
Would probably be either a split or, like, a short, small release. Just to kind of... I know everyone's hungry for new music. Once you get, like, some, you're just like, oh, man, I want that band to make more. But then you realize... costs a lot of money.
Yeah.
Also have to write those songs. It takes a while. But we really want to try to do a split with someone, and we kind of have material in the works, but we're not in a rush, so don't quote me on like, oh, there's going to be a split out this time. Don't even think about that.
Yeah.
If it comes out, just be glad it did.
Yeah, but probably more stuff like involving that one, like music video.
Yeah, and then,
videos,
you know, just like, get us in your city.
Come.
You know, just tell us to play in your city and we'll come there.
Yeah.
We'll try to at least.
Yeah. There you go.
That's the plan. Play as much as possible.
Promote the album. Anything to just, like, do stuff with the album. Yeah. Yeah.
Very cool. And you guys, Joe, next question for you. You won a Canadian Music League trophy.
Oh, yeah, that's just, so at my work, we have, like, a little competition. I used to be a student at my work, or it's, like, Ontario Conservatory Music. It's, like, all the Ontario Conservatory Music students kind of compete against each other, like, students of their level in different genres, and I used to enter because it's fun. I don't know, it's just fun to play in front of people, and my students do it now, too, and I think I've won a couple times. It's just a fun thing to do. It's just, like, a music competition that my... guitar school used to hold when I was younger. Canadian Music League makes it sound like way bigger than it actually is. But it's pretty big for the school, so good times.
Hmm. Alright, and I have to ask you guys, do you need a spoon player?
Definitely not. Sorry. If you're trying to like easy way in.
We already think xylophone.
I don't think we'll ever use spoons ever. Quote me. And if we do ever use spoons, dig up this interview and just be like, hey, you were never gonna use those. Yeah. But I don't think we'll ever use them. I'm sorry. Unless you put them through like a fuzz pedal and like lots of delay and reverb or something. If that's possible. What would that sound like? Maybe we should try that.
Xylophone through like a thing.
Can you? Yeah. You know mic, what? What's something? What's the
run it through like reverb and delays?
What's the one that has like the vibrato effect built in already? Is it called the xylophone or
the wooden one?
No, can't remember what it's called, but there's one that's like has like a cool vibrato effect. It could be just a xylophone with that like effect, but there's like an instrument, like a mallet instrument, that's really cool that I would actually consider.
No,
definitely not spoons.
Sure. Very interesting. Now, also, this year you guys played Rock the Coliseum.
Yeah, that was cool.
Yeah, but tell me about the experience for you guys.
I really liked the setting, like the little area that was played cool. in. Unfortunately,
a lot of great bands too.
Yeah, there was a really good lineup. Unfortunately, I had to work. I work nights, so it's kind of hard to play a lot of shows. And I try to avoid rescheduling, like, work. So I'll just, like, the week after I had to reschedule for another gig, so I kind of work the hours that I can. So right after we played, I went to work. So yeah. I missed, like, almost everything.
So we played for...
The pictures were really nice.
We could have played the second day, like...
Yeah, we could have played on the second day, too? But Zach also was streaming a tournament, so like a two-day tournament.
We played pretty early, which is sort of unfortunate, but it was fine. It was like, there was a decent crowd.
Yeah, it's just a cool environment, and there's a lot of cool bands, and I wish they made use of that space more. But obviously, I guess it would take away from the event as a whole, but it's a cool space, and I'm glad that it's happening. And
yeah,
I wish more people would go out to it. I don't know. The turnout was okay, but I feel like it'd be cool just to pack that small venue.
Yeah, I've seen pictures of the event from when it was even called the Bleeding Hearts Festival, and around the middle years, like 2007, 2008, even 2009, there was like you could crowd surf.
Yeah, like more people, I think, just used to go to shows in general. That's what it looks like. Yeah. So people should, you know, just go, just come out. It's fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And for you guys, your thoughts on Mississauga? What are your thoughts on Mississauga as well? I'm curious.
In general,
the city or like
musically, and then even the city because we do have a beautiful skyline.
I
really like Mississauga
for a really nice and big city. Not enough venues. Like, where are all your venues, Saga?
Yes,
come on.
That
like,
is true.
I think Brampton has like more places to play, and we're not even as cool as you guys.
Yeah, I feel like Mississauga is like a nicer Brampton.
Yeah.
Anyways.
Yeah.
I went to school here, so...
No venues.
Yeah.
Bands-wise, I really like it. I really like the Mississauga music scene, and I talked about earlier the sense of community that they try to build. Like, with bands like Huge Cosmic and Terry Green, River Groves, like, every time you go to a show with the Saga band, like, you'll see someone you know now. Like, I can go to any of those shows, and I'll be able to hang out with, like, you know, like, the bands there, just because they're so tight-knit, and they'll book each other for shows. They'll come out to everyone's shows. So it's really cool to see that, and there's a lot of cool, like, music stuff going on here. I feel like Brampton was very, I don't know, it was kind of like either pop rock or hardcore, like, a lot of it. Although now the bands kind of leading the way are very different, but I felt like Mississauga was always kind of doing, like, more, like, indie rock, like, kind of more niche genres. But yeah, just overall, a lot of great bands. I think Huge Cosmic's one of my favorite bands, like, maybe my favorite local band. I really like other bands I mentioned, River Groves, Terry Green. There's a lot of other good bands that we're not, like, too close with, but they're very good. Bike Thieves, Yonder Peak. There's a lot of bands here. I don't know. It's just a solid scene. All the shows here, like, that they do have, there's nowhere to play, but when they do put on a show at the Sonic Lodge, it's, like, a good show to go to. So I feel like it's a good scene, it just needs more places to play. Yeah, Saga. It's cool.
Yeah. Very cool.
The Mississauga music scene group on Facebook is way more fun than the Brampton music scene group, by the way.
Well, we do try.
Yeah. Adrian. It's that Adrian guy. Always saying something. Something. I don't know. Always saying something. Shout out to Adrian. It's funny. He has a funny Twitter.
Yes, he does.
And he does, like, hype stuff that people get mad about, but I think it's good for the scene. Like, pretending to book Heavy at the Lodge. And pretending to book Guy Fieri at the Lodge. That's funny. And I think it helps just create buzz, you know, and it's good for the scene. Some people didn't really care for those jokes, but, you know, it's good times.
Well, I mean, but Guy Fieri could cook for us.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, actually, that didn't make any sense. But Heavy at the Lodge, like, I hate Heavy, but I'd go to that show, you know?
Oh, I'd go to that show with I'd have tomatoes in my backpack, but I'd go to that show.
Yeah.
Now, I do have to ask you guys as well, my last two questions. Facial hair.
Love it.
I wish I could grow a full beard.
Yeah, I mean...
Mine's pretty scrappy.
I think I have the most facial hair out of everyone in the band.
Joe's our beard guy.
I think Mel has the least. That was a joke. And
Zach
then,
doesn't have a lot of
Zach doesn't hair. Have a lot, he does like a little beard thing. So it's like me, and Jeff, and Zach. But yeah, we're huge fans. Our friends are good supporters of facial hair. They have nice facial hair.
Yeah, Joe's our beard guy.
Thing. Yeah.
There's a beard guy in the band, it's Joe.
Yeah. It's important for me to have a beard too, because Zach doesn't have a beard. So again, trying to look different from Zach is a thing that I think about. But yeah, like I'll just like shave all of it off, like barely ever trim, and then just grow it out for like 3 months because I don't want to shave again, and then just out of laziness. But I like it. Yeah.
Just curious, what's the hardest part for you guys have found being a band, just really the
hardest part being a band. I think for us, it's just like there's four of us, and just coordinating like everyone's lives. Like we're all trying to have like our own life, but also have this life together as a band, and it's really hard to coordinate when I don't know. Like I work nights, Zach works days, like little things like that. Jeff's in school, Mel's in school. Everyone's kind of in different spots at different times, and it's never really lining up the same way for us to give like our full attention. And it's hard to give your full attention because I mean it's like not like a safe career financially, so you can't really just drop everything you have to kind of go at this. So we're all trying to work, we're all trying to go to school and try to make a living for ourselves, but we really want to push this music thing. So it's just kind of finding that balance and getting everyone on the same page, being able to coordinate like events and play as many shows as possible, but still kind of, you know, like, keep our life going. So, if you want to see us do a lot of things, just give us a ton of money, and we'll just quit our jobs, and we'll focus on music altogether. You know what I'm saying? But, like, that's the dream, right? But it's hard to achieve that dream. And I think that's the hardest thing for us. And also, no one replies to emails. So annoying.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, like, even on top of that, it's, like, the hard part about being in a band is, like, knowing where to go and like how to get there.
Yeah,
a lot of it's just like you just do things and you hope something comes.
Yeah, you hope for the
best.
You
just like play a lot of shows and you hope like people
like,
listen to you.
I hate turning down shows.
Yeah,
I can't do it. And we've played some terrible shows like that were definitely really like shows. Probably not worth our time. But in my mind, I'm like, that could have been the one where like this happens.
Yeah.
You know. So I have to play everything.
You release an album like, you don't know what will come of it.
Yeah.
But you just try to do it and you hope for the best.
Yeah.
That's sort of like the hard part about being bent. There's like no
path. There's no clear-cut path, so.
So like everything comes with a risk, you know?
Yeah. So it's just hard to kind of dive in.
Yeah.
And, you know, still keep it going. But I feel like maybe, hopefully one time there'll just be a time where you do know, like, what decision to make.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, yeah, just trying to do as much as possible while balancing everything else.
Very cool. Am I cooler than... All right, guys. Well, thank you for a wonderful
interview.
Awesome.
Thank you so
thank
much.
You.
That was really fun.
Yeah, that was awesome. I like talking.
As you can see.
Yeah. Like, I just said that for no reason.
Video,
just,
like,
to say, just to say that I like talking.
Talked for, like, an hour more than me.
And any final words to people, you guys?
If you somehow found this without going to our Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram, or YouTube, or whatever, then go to our Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, Twitter, SoundCloud.
Yeah.
All of them are /new design music at the end, and then Bandcamp's newdesignmusic.bandcamp.com. Check out the new album, Far From Home. Like, we think it's really good, so.
If you have already checked it out, thank you for checking it out.
Yeah, listen to it again, though, also.
Support your scene.
Yeah, just music. go to shows.
That's sort of the main theme of like, those broader questions we had today.
Just yeah, like, the scene, it's cool.
Help the scene, man.
It's a fun thing to be a part of, and I feel like if you go to a lot of shows, you can really, like, you know, make a lot of friends. You just have to kind of
be... There's a lot of great bands, honestly.
Yeah, and just don't be afraid to talk to any bands you really like, and I know it's kind of scary. I remember going to shows and not wanting to, like, and, you know, and then you approach those bands, and you realize they're really cool people, and you make good connections, so... even as a fan or a band, it's a great thing to do. So just go to shows, talk to people, hear some cool music. Remember that local bands, I feel like, are giving it like 100%. You know what I'm saying? Like, you'll go see like a band for like $100 and they just autopilot the show sometimes. Yeah. Whereas you can go see a local show for $5-$10 and see like a bunch of bands like giving it their all and really trying with the music they're trying to like making and not being influenced by anything else. So it's... that's like a whole other thing I could get into, but just the local music's really important. There's a lot of great bands that you never would have known if you didn't go up.
That's it. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, guys.